So if you go into your 40s and you find your brain going, everything's not okay, then just pause for a moment and try not to think outside of you, because it would be very easy, especially this is the cruelty of menopause, is a lot of our kids become teenagers as we are going deep into menopause. That's rough.
Never underestimate the power of a ruptured appendix. I remember when I came out, I couldn't do paleo. My gut only tolerated meat. I did carnivore for months and months and months. I had sworn I would never do just carnivore. And it was actually something that helped heal my gut. So,
and then honoring that menstruation. I loved what you said about, like, I almost wish I had a cycle again. Like, now that I understand it at 53, I'm like, sheesh, I wish I understood it at 33 like I understand it now.
Many listeners know that you are very, keto, probiotics in general, fermented foods, how important they are. Someone asked, when adding sauerkraut, and I apologize to those that submitted questions, but my wonderful team did not add the person's name, so I can't say. Lindsay asked, we'll just do, this is question number three. Yeah. When adding sauerkraut to a meal, is it best for gut health to eat it first or at the end of the meal, and why?
Oh, that's a great question.
Yeah.
I've never gotten that question. you know what? I would say that you either eat it with the meal or before the meal, because it's your microbes that help regulate blood sugar and break that food down and pull the nutrients out of it. I think that's the biggest thing that people don't realize, that we put so much focus, if we just even take the mitochondria, like how many thousands of hours of conversation about the mitochondria have you had, and how many hacks out there to like hack the mitochondria? But really it's your microbes that are going to determine what happens to your food, which is why sauerkraut's amazing. So we typically do a grass-fed steak with a sweet potato and then a cup of sauerkraut. That's a pretty common meal. And I just eat it all together. I don't know about you, but it's not my favorite. So I either eat it before or with the meal just to get it down.
Yeah, it's interesting. There's a manufacturer of a locally grown kraut, and they have all these kind of more exotic krauts, things that have got curries in them and, coriander. And so I usually will stand at the refrigerator with a fork and I'll take a couple bites of my kraut as I'm like reheating, because usually I'm like in reheating mode as I'm, reheating something for lunch or I'm cooking dinner. And I'll use it preemptively, but I agree with you. I think taking it with a meal or prior to a meal is the way to do it. Yeah. And the other thing that's the kind of second part of this question was someone on social media underneath actually added, well, if your gut's healthy, why do you need probiotic rich foods? Which I thought was, this is a common perception. I think for a lot of people, they're like, it's just not important if your gut is healthy. But I would probably argue that most, if not all of us, have gut health issues we need to work on, even if we're not aware of it presently.
Yeah. Oh my God. Again, such a good conversation. I think what we have to realize is that, we always talk about the trillions of bacteria in our gut. But if you look at species-wise, how many species of bacteria are in there? The statistics I've seen have been anywhere from a couple thousand up to 7,000 different types of bacteria. And each one of these bacteria are going to do something different. And they each have a food that they're going to resonate with that the other set of bacteria may not. So my experience has been, and I'd be curious your opinion on this as well, has been that people eat the same foods over and over and over again. Sauerkraut can be the same thing. You eat the same sauerkraut over and over and over again. And so you create a monoculture. And I think what we've got to get back to is understanding that the name of the game is to keep diversifying your foods so that you can keep neurotransmitter production up. You can keep your immune system up so you can feed the bacteria that break estrogen down. And so those become massively important, whether you're trying to repair your gut or not. I don't have any gut problems, but feeding these microbes is on my mind every single day.
Yeah. And I always jokingly say that monogamy is a good thing in relationships, but food monogamy is not. We want to try different things. And I'm as guilty of it as the next person. Like I love steak. I love bison. I love eggs. I incorporate them throughout the week, but I'm always trying different fermented foods because I'm dairy free. So for me, it's really like leaning into those fermented vegetables, but I have fermented okra. I mean, I have kraut. I have multiple kinds of kraut. In fact, my husband told me the other day, he thinks we have science experiments going on the top shelf. And I'm like, no, they're all healthy. Right. But you know, he's like, anyone that wants to eat fermented okra, he's like, only my wife. And I said, no, but it's good to try different things every day because I fervently believe. And as someone who, you know, three and a half years ago, I was on 6 weeks of antifungals, antibiotics, and then got another round of antibiotics when I had my appendix out. And so I remind people that just one dose of antibiotics can impact your gut microbiome, I think anywhere from 18 months to 2 years. And so for me, I'm still actively working diligently on my gut. And you just think about the average person probably needs more fermented foods, beverages, et cetera, than they're probably consuming right now.
And on that point, I also, if you eat out, you're getting glyphosate. And if you eat wheat, the wheat right now has, you know, in America has BT toxin in it, which is going to affect those microbes. So it's just, there's just so, we live in this world where there's so many things trying to deplete our microbial health. Let's make a stand for always helping to grow it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and especially, you know, as we are getting older, understanding that, you know, as we have less hydrochloric acid production, as we could potentially be, you know, no longer making as vibrant digestive enzymes, as we are exposed to more estrogen mimicking chemicals in our food, environment, personal care products, just understanding that we diligently every day want to be doing, even if it's small things that are going to benefit the gut microbiome. I always say I humbly bow at the temple that is the gut microbiome, because the more I learn, the more I just kind of I'm fascinated that we humans kind of bumble through life and don't even think about it.
Yes. Amen to that.
Next question is about, if I indulge in something sweet from time to time, would organic sugar or maybe honey be better than, say, agave, or should I use pure stevia?
Oh my gosh. These are good questions. I love it. Okay. Well, I think you got to look at what personal preference. So I personally do not like stevia, so I don't gravitate to stevia type foods. So there's that. And then you could look at the glycemic index and say, well, okay, stevia has got zero, supposedly. Agave's, I think, under like 10 on the glycemic index. It's a little bit lower. Honey's around a 30 or a 40, and organic sugar, even though it's organic, is up around a 70. And the higher the glycemic number, the more of an insulin response you're going to have. So you choose, you're going to have to think about that if you're concerned about your sugar addiction or craving. Now, the nuance on that is stevia sometimes can trigger that same sort of desire for more sugar. So it's a really tricky one. But I would say I choose mine off a personal preference, and I choose it off glycemic index. And I don't know about you, Cynthia, but I've spent a lot of years as a sugar addict. And for me, I know if I eat sugar like 3 days in a row, there becomes like a point of no return where now I have to really hunker down to make sure I don't have sugar again. So I'm very, very careful to not have it too much for fear that will trigger that old pattern back.
Yeah. And it's interesting because I would imagine most, if not all of us, are actually at least mildly addicted to sugar because it just proliferates. It's in our condiments, it's in our ketchup, it's in our salad dressings. I would agree with you that for each one of us, we have to decide, you know, can we tolerate one square of high quality dark chocolate? Right. Can we tolerate some of these items? Like, I really don't use honey. I mean, maybe in the past I might've used honey, but I really tried to avoid using a lot of sugars personally, because as you mentioned, you start getting this dopamine hit. It feels good. You want more. Obviously we're heading into Christmas at my house and New Year's. We'll have family here in a couple of days. And I was actually saying to my kids, you know, for me, I have to plan. Like, if I'm going to indulge in something, I know what the net impact will be the following day. So it's finding I tolerate a little bit. Personally, I find that a lot of the artificial or the contrived sugars, monk fruit, erythritol, tend to be perhaps a little bit better tolerated. People can tolerate some of the sugar alcohols, like with erythritol, My 15-year-old has been experimenting with Swerve, which has been interesting to watch. With that being said, I generally say agave is a no-go because agave is straight fructose and it's metabolized very differently. And I know a lot of people still think of it as being very benign. I watched a friend pouring it all over her pancakes and I kind of just cringed watching it, thinking that this is not going to have a good end result. And I've talked quite a bit, and I'm sure you probably have seen that paper about non-nutritive sweeteners that came out probably 2 months ago that was talking about the net impact of sucralose, NutraSweet, saccharin, which I don't know where anyone is using any saccharin at this point in time. And then looking at stevia, and just for a 28-day period, using those sweeteners, again, some are artificial, depending on what type of stevia it wasn't identified, change the gut microbiome as well as impact oral glucose tolerance. And so I think it really speaks to the fact that all of us need to examine our relationship with sugar.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, again, if we can get to sugar that has more fiber in it, like an apple, it's going to have a different blood sugar spike. And then like one of my favorite things, since I know this is going to come out in January, but one of my favorite holiday things is I make a wicked pumpkin pie. I use coconut sugar and I use so much full fat in it. So if you pair, and it's so good, it fills me up and it's not like I'm craving sugar the next day. So I think pairing a fat with your favorite sugar is also a trick that seems to not, for me as an ex-sugar addict, it doesn't seem to cause me to crave it the next day.
That's a really good point. It's interesting. I really like dark chocolate. That's like my one vice left. Yeah. But what I've been trying is doing some dark chocolate with, you know, maybe a teaspoon of MCT oil, because then I'm satiated, because I think that's part of the problem is that when we eat some of these foods, if there's not enough fat associated with it, that it can kind of trigger these desires to continue eating it. Like if I'm eating a piece of dark chocolate, sometimes I'll have a scoop of high quality nut butter, and that's usually what I will pair together that I find is really impactful. And I agree with you about the fruit. You know, fruit in its whole form, whether it's an orange or some berries, or if you have an apple, preferably, you know, not one of the ones that's engineered to be super sweet. I was trying to explain to my kids when I was talking about how modern day farming has really continued to evolve and to mature, quote unquote, this sugar desire, because Honeycrisp apples, Gala, Fuji apples, are apples that tend to be a bit sweeter. You know, it's not like the Macintosh that I'm sure you and I had when we were kids, because there weren't a lot of options. Pippins. Maybe there was like a Golden Delicious. I mean, there were very few options, you know, back then in the 70s and 80s, but now there's this proliferation of very sweet apples, and understanding that furthers that desire to eat more sugar. We just don't recognize it as such.
Yeah. Yeah. Well said. Isn't that fascinating? I was sitting there thinking as you were talking, like, if we look at the trends in nutrition, we jumped all into the low fat movement back when you and I were growing up, you know, in the 70s and the 80s. And then we had to course correct by adding sugar because nothing's really good without fat. And so we changed everybody's taste buds to the point that we're now even highlighting the more sweet fruits out there because everybody's taste bud is so conditioned for that. So I over time, I would say the majority of my diet is meat and vegetables. I love sweet potatoes, probably because of what it does to my hormones. I love me some good dark chocolate for the same reason. But I think if, as you change your food habits and you're using foods that are more nutrient dense and they are feeding your hormones, they're feeding the cells in such an efficient way, you start to see that sweetness is not really something you crave. And I know that's impossible for people to think about if that's all they can think of, you know, want is sugar. But I promise you over time, it just all of a sudden goes away. And I say that as an ex-sugar addict.
Yeah, I think that transparency is super helpful. It was interesting. I was stuck in a very long delay at Chicago O'Hare's airport on Saturday coming back from LA. And ironically, my gate was across from McDonald's. And so I was watching this group of people. They were like going over to McDonald's and getting a meal, and they were coming back and then getting ice cream. And then, you know, it was so bad that United rolled out a card essentially to apologize for all these, you know, lengthy delays, a 7-hour delay. And I just watched this crowd of people, no judgment, but I mean, everyone like woofed down all the Cheez-Its and the Goldfish crackers and, you know, the Fig Newtons and all the other things that were there. And I walked over, grabbed a bottle of water, and sat back down and someone said to me, well, it's been so many hours since you last ate, you must be starving. And I was like, nope.
Oh my gosh. Every time I'm in an airport, I am so grateful that I've trained myself to fast. Because I watch the people, or even like I recently got off coffee, watching the people in the lines. It's like, wow, it's hard. And I say this with love and compassion, but I also say it as you can do it yourself as well, that, you know, but there's nothing worse than waiting in line for food or coffee in the airport, especially if you have to catch a plane. So totally get it.
Yeah. Yet another benefit of fasting is that right. If you need to fast, you can, you know, effortlessly do that.
That's right.
Now, because you were just speaking about balancing hormones, we got questions specific to progesterone as well as estrogen, and you do a really nice job in your book talking about this. Let's unpack which foods, because there's a lot of questions around this, what foods are beneficial for progesterone production and the body. And for many people that are in perimenopause, understanding physiologically what's going on in the body and why this can be very helpful.
Yeah. Yeah. So here's in the book, I have a line, it's probably my favorite line in the book, where I say that we have to look at estrogen and progesterone as like twin sisters with vastly different personalities. And so we need to feed them something different. And I would say when you look at just the basics, when you look at estrogen, in general, when estrogen is coming in, the lower glycemic, the lower glucose foods are going to be great. This is where your meats and your vegetables. Oh my God, estrogen, if she could talk to you, she would say, feed me more leafy greens than you could possibly handle. I think also some of your beneficial oils like flaxseed oil, she really thrives with those healthy oils. A little more of a ketogenic diet is really what estrogen needs. Progesterone's completely the other way. She's like, don't give me low glycemic foods. I need glucose to be a little bit higher to be able to be show up and be produced. So again, the sweet potato, I feel like is the hero of the progesterone day. I have sweet potatoes all the time. And by the way, I do back to the microbe thing. We do variety of sweet potatoes. Have you ever wondered, like when you're at the market, like that we call them all sweet potatoes and yams, but what are they really? Cause some of them are purple on the inside. Some of them are white. Some of them are yellow. Some of them are orange. The skin color's different, but they're all in the same section. And so we did some research a couple of years back and found out that the purple ones actually have a specific purpose, not that anybody really knows this, but to feed the bacteria in your large intestine, down deep into the large intestine, whereas the other sweet potatoes tend to go in the not the small intestine, but the more entry point in the large intestine. So I never looked at different foods feeding different microbes along the transit process, which is really interesting. So sweet potatoes are great. Chocolate, dark chocolate. I don't think we should fear chocolate, but I'm not saying go out and eat, Hershey's chocolate. So you got to be really smart about your super, super dark chocolate is incredible. The other thing, progesterone, that in the keto world, everybody's scared of, and I've actually brought this back in, is bananas. You know, tropical fruits, mangoes, bananas, great for progesterone. Citrus fruits, great for progesterone. Grass-fed meats are still really good. Quinoa, rices. So it's very much when we want to bring progesterone up, we got to bring glucose up, but do it with nature's carbs. Don't do it with other carbs.
I feel like I got inflamed overnight. I suddenly couldn't sleep well. Nothing was working right. And so I would love to kind of dive into a conversation about how to support women as they're making this transition. And I know intermittent fasting can be a piece of that, but what are we doing wrong? Like, what is our conventional mindset about that transitional period? What are we doing wrong for our patients?
So great question. Great question. Sorry, you can keep going. I love the way you phrase that, because I think that's what the right question to ask. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a little bit of how I stumbled upon fasting, detoxing, keto, diet variation for my own perimenopause, menopause journey. Mm-hmm. And it really was like when I hit 40, I felt like I was in the best shape of my life. Mm-hmm. And to me at that time, that meant very long runs, hour, 2 hour runs on a Sunday morning. Yeah. I ran all the time. I worked out like a maniac. Mm-hmm. I was paleo at the time. And so I was eating really well. I was taking supplements, like doing classically mm-hmm. all the right things. So at 40, I felt great. Mm-hmm. But by the time I hit 43, I felt horrible. Yeah. I wasn't sleeping. I had hot flashes. Mm-hmm. I was gaining weight. Didn't make sense. I was doing all the same mm-hmm. things. And so I actually stumbled. I kept asking people, like, what do you, like a lot of my friends, because right, this is what we do yeah. with, as women. We're like, let's go ask our girlfriends. Yeah. let me ask my big sister, yeah. like, yeah. what's your experience? And they all looked at me and said, they laughed and they're like, oh, you're just going through perimenopause. Mm-hmm. This is it. Get ready. It's going to be this horrible.
Yeah.
And I remember thinking, like, this is the human body is not meant to break down at 43. Something Correct. Is not right.
Yeah.
And one day I stumbled upon a good friend of mine who's an OBGYN, very well respected in the community that I was a part of where we were raising our kids together. And I told her my symptoms and I was waiting for this like miraculous answer from mm-hmm. her. Like at that point I was like, surely she's going to tell me like, get on some fancy medication or do something. Like I was so desperate for the one mm-hmm. trick. And instead she turned to me and she said, Mindy, I have a practice full of women like this mm-hmm. and my medical textbooks have failed me.
Yeah.
And I have no idea what to do with these women. What are you doing with these women? Then she flipped mm-hmm. it on me knowing that I did nutrition and detox mm-hmm. and was like, give me advice.
Right.
And so I walked away from that conversation and I realized if it's happening to every woman, mm-hmm. then it has to be something environmental. Mm-hmm. And by environmental, I mean toxins, but I also mean it's how we live our lives. And I think what most women don't realize and the question that I'd love or the conversation I'd love to have with every mm-hmm. 35-year-old woman mm-hmm. is that once 40 hits, your ovaries are going to be done mm-hmm. and they're going to slowly, it's not like it's done overnight. They're going to slowly decline. It's going to take 10 to 15 years for these mm-hmm. ovaries to be out, but you literally have an organ that is done doing its job. Mm-hmm. It'd be like, if your like heart was like, hey, I'm done. I'm just going to slowly like this. I don't understand why we don't talk about this.
Right.
So it, as those ovaries start to check out, they have to hand the job of making sex hormones, progesterone, testosterone, mm-hmm. estrogen, over to other organs. Mm-hmm. And usually the main organ they hand it over to is the adrenals. Mm-hmm. So now you put me in a room of, you know, 45-year-old women, and they are stressed out, overworked. Yeah. They're most, by the time you're at that point, your kids are usually like in four different sports and mm-hmm. five different, learning five different languages. And I mean, the pace for the 45-year-old woman is so intense that there's no way she can balance her sex hormones.
Yeah.
So the question that we all need to ask ourselves is what can we do differently starting at 40 so that mm-hmm. we can ride this decline of hormones? And this is where intermittent fasting and keto and all mm-hmm. these principles can really be life-changing.
And I think people don't need to be afraid of it. I mean, a lot of the rhetoric that I hear across social media, and I talk very openly, I'm 49, so I'm not a spring chicken, but I'm still a very, you know, youthful woman. Yeah. I like to think youthful. But at 49, I understand this so much better than I did 5 years ago. And I think so many of us kind of bumble through our lives and we're like, oh, I'll deal with that later. And so the conversation that I want to have with women in their 30s is like, listen, the better you take care of yourself now, the easier that transition will be. You don't have to go through perimenopause and be horribly inflamed and not be able to sleep and have chronic hot flashes. Like there's a woman I met and I felt so badly. She had suffered for 5 years. She was like 52. And she said, I haven't slept well in 5 years. And she said, I've tried everything. Horrible. And I said, but if we don't work on what's driving that, like we've got to get on the sleep piece. And for anyone that's listening, my standard mantra is if I cannot get you to sleep through the night, I cannot get you to lose weight. Let me make that very, very clear.
That's
sleep
a good
is foundational to our health. And so for anyone who's listening who thinks, oh, it's not a big deal, it is a big deal. So if we can ratchet in on, you know, being a little kinder to our bodies and not doing chronic cardio and getting outside in nature, you know, I'm in Washington, DC. And so I would say 9 months out of the year, it's the weather's decent enough that you can do that. You know, there's a couple months where it's pretty cold, but you can still put a hat on and a coat and go outside. But, you know, there's so many things that you can do for your body beneficially, like even getting into meditation, which I was so hesitant to do. And yep. yet we want to tap into that parasympathetic, the rest and repose side of our brains, because we're so sympathetic dominant in this culture that we're in. I mean, I think anyone that's in a westernized country, maybe during social distancing and COVID, maybe things have slowed down a little bit for most of us.
Oh, and, yeah. You know,
the pace great. That our lives was driving at was not sustainable.
Yeah.
So when you're having these conversations with your female patients, where does it start from? Like, what are people most receptive to changing first? Because I find if you try to lay it all out at once, it's so overwhelming. And
it's a lot. Like,
no yeah. way. I can't do that all.
Yeah. Well, gosh, there's so many things to tie into what you're saying that, you know, if you want, the first thing you want to do is support these adrenal glands mm-hmm. because they're about to take on an extra load. Mm-hmm. So if you just go to that one organ by itself and ask yourself, what can I do to support it? Now, it'd be easy to say, we'll throw a bunch of supplements at it, but our bodies are miraculous and we don't always need to throw supplements at it. We often need to just change our lifestyle. Mm-hmm. So I did the same thing. You brought this up. I changed my workouts. That was like one of the first things I did. I stopped running really long. Mm-hmm. I started doing more yoga. Mm-hmm. I really dramatically got off that chronic. I need to, in order to keep my weight where I want, I need to be able to, I have to exercise like a crazy woman. Mm-hmm. I changed that behavior first. Yeah. The second behavior then became, okay, since a lot of women are focused on weight loss, well, if I'm not going to be exercising like a maniac, how am I going to keep my weight? Well, that's where fasting mm-hmm. comes in, is that once I started to intermittent fast and then I started to learn like 24-hour fast mm-hmm. and do some longer fasts, I found I didn't need to work out. Mm-hmm. the same way that I did before. So, okay, now I've got fasting going into it. Mm-hmm. Then when I looked at, well, I was paleo for many years and before paleo, I was gluten-free. Mm-hmm. And so I'm like, well, if I intermittent fast and then I keep my breads and pastas and all of those kind of refined carbs mm-hmm. out, and protein, I'm a fan of sort of moderate protein, mm-hmm. not too much protein, but maybe I lean into more good fat. Mm-hmm. Now my blood sugar's more stable. My energy's more stable. I'm keeping my weight down. And so you can see, and now I'm not requiring my adrenals to have this like up, down, up, yeah. down moment. So to me, those are kind of the three biggest shifts mm-hmm. is that you've got to stop stressing the body out with the chronic exercise. And that really goes for also your life. You got to learn to say no to things a little bit more and then start fasting and then start bringing that blood sugar down with the foods you're eating. And those three things, I mean, we see it in our online world, like those are game changers for Absolutely. Women in their 40s.
Absolutely. And you know, that the sad thing is that as we get into perimenopause and menopause, we're more prone to insulin resistance. Like I would say out of 15 private coaching clients I have right now, a third of them easily are relatively thin women. They don't have a lot of weight to lose and they're all insulin resistant. And yep. so, you know, for me, I keep reminding them that, you know, you can be doing all the right things and we're just so much more prone to insulin resistance as we're getting older that blood sugar stability or dysregulation, if it's not well stabilized, can really be a huge difference. And I was teasing with my so I have all boys. So I'm the only female in my house, including
Oh my gosh.
And so I was telling my kids over the weekend that I allowed myself, I was like, I don't do it very often. I just had a day where I just had a little more, I like dark chocolate. That's probably my one vice. Had a little bit of dark chocolate, had a lot more than I would normally. And so my way around that is, you know, I can take chromium GTF, I can take berberine. And I took 2 berberine, and berberine we know is one of those supplements. And for anyone that's listening, I'm not a fan. I always start with the food piece and then supplements if needed. But I knew for myself, I could tell my blood sugar was up. I started to get some hot flashes. I didn't feel quite so good. I was like, wow, this harkens me back to maybe how I felt 5 or 6 years ago, even when I was eating relatively healthy things. And so it was a good reinforcement for me, just being aware of how we feel when we eat certain foods. And you know, you mentioned going gluten-free, that there's so much alignment between us. I went gluten-free, then I went paleo, then I went lower carb.
Yep.
fully ketogenic all the time, but I probably flux in and out. But what maybe worked for you in your 30s in terms of nutrition may not work for you as you're getting older. Like, dairy is not my friend. I don't do well with dairy. I've accepted this. We've broken up amicably.
I've heard a lot of women say that, by the way.
Well, it's funny. One of my providers calls it the dairy five, meaning for many women, as soon as they get rid of dairy, they lose that last 5 pounds they couldn't get rid of. And so the point of what I'm saying is, you know, the N of one, you know, kind of figuring out for yourself what works. And it might be someone tolerates grains, someone else doesn't. Maybe someone tolerates dairy, someone else doesn't. But you have to do a little bit of experimentation and not be rigid with yourself. I think that's, you know, giving ourselves the grace, you know, it's a lot of what you're alluding to.
And I think this is what I put in the menopause reset is, you know, when I went to go write that book, I was like, I don't want to write a book about all the magic pills, alternative pills you can take, the magic, I call them the magic mushroom, mm-hmm. you know, for women who don't want to do HRT. So they want to know all the alternative. Like, I was not interested in writing a book about that. What I was mm-hmm. interested in doing is helping educate women that once you hit 40, your lifestyle needs to be different. Mm-hmm. And I think that was my, like, aha, is I just kept the same lifestyle that I had in 20 and 30, and I just carried it into 40 and it stopped working.
Right.
And it would have been so easy to just call it menopause and start to medicate. But because of what I know about the body, it was like, why is the body performing like this? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what I want women to know, is at 40, the lifestyle has to change.
Yeah.
And the sooner you wake up to that, the less pain and suffering you're going to have as you go through this journey.
And I think that's so important. It's a message of hope that you do have control. And sometimes it means you have to make some small changes. Some, for other people, maybe larger changes that can allow you to continue to age, you know, age gracefully and age in a way where you feel like you are still your authentic self and you're just kind of making tweaks. So let's pivot a little bit. Like, what makes fasting different for women in perimenopause and menopause? Mm-hmm. Because I think, you know, women, while they're still cycling, still in their fertile years, it's very different than it is as we're making these transitions. And how do we navigate this and use it as a successful strategy?
Yeah. Well, so with fasting, and are we talking about fasting or keto and fasting? Are we separating those two out?
So let's start with fasting and then we'll pivot into keto, because I think it's important for people to hear other than from me. I feel like sometimes it's always helpful to have another woman talk about ketogenic, you know, lifestyles. Yeah, let's start with fasting and then we'll pivot.
Okay, so the best thing, and I learned this actually, I think you might have had her on your podcast. I learned this from Dr. Anna Kabeca, and it really mm-hmm. makes sense, which is that there's a hormonal hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And the hormonal hierarchy has oxytocin at the top, which is blows me away. This is why you can have a stressful day and pet your dog and all of a sudden you feel better. Mm-hmm. But oxytocin is going to control cortisol. Cortisol will control insulin, mm-hmm. and then insulin controls all the sex hormones. So if we just leave cortisol and oxytocin out of it, mm-hmm. insulin controls the sex hormones. So let's start by controlling insulin. Mm-hmm. And what we learned from Jason Fung, I mean, the obesity code was sort of the first awakening that holding on to weight is an insulin problem, not a calorie problem. Mm-hmm. So when you're looking at fasting for 40-year-olds, one of the greatest way, or for anybody, but especially if you're 40 and above, one of the greatest ways to get these sex hormones under control is for you to control insulin. And one of the greatest ways to control insulin is to start to fast. Mm-hmm. Because what it does is it makes your cells more sensitive to insulin. It makes your cells more sensitive to glucose. Mm-hmm. If you start to get into some longer fasts, like 36-hour and 48-hour fasts, you're forcing your body to go find the glucose and insulin that it stored mm-hmm. years ago. I actually think controlling insulin is more effective through fasting than even changing your food. Mm-hmm. Do you feel the same way?
I do. And the longer I fast, the more, and here, just to jump back. So we've had social distancing in our area since March. We're in Washington, DC. We're still socially distanced. Kids are doing 100% distance learning in September. And people have asked, what is the secret to how some people did or did not gain weight while socially distancing at home? And I said, well, I think it's a lot of different things, but I think one of the most critical things for me was movement every day and fasting, because I could, you know, here and there, I could eat a little more of this, a little more of that. and get back on track. But, you know, when your body is tapping into fat stores for utilization of energy, then that's much better than you're eating every 2 hours. Like, I think the average American, and this is stupefying, average American consumes food or a sweetened beverage 16 to 17 times a day. So everything
I've
but every
heard
time
that.
To create insulin 16, 17 times a day or two or three, very, very different in terms of your biomedical or biophysical profile. So I think for me personally, I do think fasting is kind of the hierarchy of, you know, kind of keeping keeping things at bay.
When I first applied fasting in my mid 40s, I was like, oh my God, I'm not sure I'm ever going to work out again.
Yeah.
Like I realized all of a sudden that I was working out to control my weight. And so then I started looking at, well, what do you like doing? I like going on hikes and I like going to yoga. And so it got me. And then I started asking myself, well, okay, if you're not using working out as a weight loss tool, you're using fasting as a weight loss tool, then where do the workouts serve you? And I've now come to a place that they're my mental health.
Yes,
that that's
exactly.
What, that's how they serve me. So, okay, let me create an exercise program around that. But fasting's my weight loss trick.
But there's been so much interest in the conversations that I've had with Dr. Mindy this year. You know, we sat on a panel with the amazing Dave Asprey and Dr. Anna Kabeca talking about fasting. And then I had the pleasure of being a guest on Dr. Mindy's podcast earlier this year. And the one thing that Mindy and I were just talking about before we started recording is that I'm at a point in my life, she's in a point in her life, we want to gravitate towards women who energetically are on the same kind of playing field mindset methodology. And so we want women that follow us and follow and listen to our podcast to feel a sense of hope heading into menopause as opposed to the sense of despair. And, you know, Mindy says it best in her new book, The Menopause Reset, you know, do you want to go surviving to thriving? And so I want everyone that's listening to have an opportunity to thrive in middle age as opposed to just surviving. And so let's start there. I know before we started recording, we were talking about, you know, you have friends and colleagues that you're starting to see some really unfortunate things that are happening in their personal lives because we're so unprepared for this time period in our lives. And, yeah. And I think it's in some instances, I have a dear college friend who went through a pretty nasty divorce recently. I think they're both in better positions, but let's kind of talk about some of the feelings around middle age that women perhaps feel uncomfortable talking to their spouse about or significant other, maybe even worse yet, feel uncomfortable talking to their girlfriends or their loved ones about. So let's start there because we have to be able to express ourselves, even if it's ugly. Like I was telling my husband, and you'll appreciate this. Last time we connected, I was taking hormone replacement therapy and I had to do a timeout because I had too much estrogen circulating. I felt really terrible. Long story. But one of the things that has impacted is that I definitely feel a change in my mood. And so I've really been very proactive saying to my husband, I definitely feel, you know, I'm feeling this way or I'm feeling that way. And he's been great. But I acknowledge that not every woman in middle age may have the degree of support that she needs. So what are your thoughts on how to support women emotionally and how to encourage women to talk about their feelings?
Yeah. Oh my God. That's a deep question. I love it. You know, the first thing I always say when people ask me about menopause and they have a co-ed audience, I always say, hopefully if there's men listening, like, listen, because you will understand the women in your life better if you understand her, what she goes through hormonally after 40. So I think there's two sides of this equation. One is helping women understand what she's hormonally going through, helping her articulate that to the men in her life or the people in her life, and then giving her tools that she can thrive with. And what my own experience with menopause was, is there was none of that. Like I literally, it was as simple, Cynthia, as like at 40, I felt like a flipping rock star. Like I was like at the top of my game. I felt invincible. By 43, I was honestly having suicidal thoughts. I wasn't sleeping. I was depressed. I was anxious. It was like somebody had hijacked my mind. And all I could think was, if this is what it's like,
I don't want to live in this. Like, if this is what my brain is going to do for the rest of my life, I don't want to be there. And so when I went to go search for answers, you know, it's, and I talk about this in the menopause reset, I got everything from, you know, an OB at my kid's school saying, like, I don't know what to do with these people. Like, do you know, you're a natural doctor? What are you doing? And I'm like, no, I need to know how you can help me. Yeah. And she's like, I have nothing. And I, and you know, what really shocked me is she literally said to me, Mindy, my medical textbooks have failed me. I have nothing to help you with. And then I went to my friends who were like 3 and 4 years older than me, and they laughed and they were like, buck up. Mm-hmm. Like, you just got to suffer through this. I had my older sister tell me to get on antidepressants. I had my mother, who I now realize grew up in a much different time. And so she didn't have all the physical, emotional, and chemical stress. She's like, menopause was nothing. Like, I was so confused. And that's where I think we start this conversation, is to women that are feeling alone, you don't understand what's going on with your brain, everybody's upsetting you. Right? Like, I want to say it's not your fault. We're, you know, Cynthia, you've been there. I've been there. And there are things you can do. And that's really what the menopause reset was, is like, here are the things that I know have worked for me. And we all have different opinions about HRT and bioidenticals. Mm-hmm. And there's a different path for every woman. Mm-hmm. But I think the first step is understanding your hormones are going to change after 40. Yeah. And it can be brutal. So we've got you. Let's walk this together. Let's talk about it, so that we don't end up lashing out at our loved ones, because that's really easy to do.
Yeah, it definitely is. And I think there's a degree, as much as it should not be the case, because we're a very age-focused culture, and unpacking that could take years to review.
That's a whole nother episode.
Exactly. But I think there's a lot of shame. A lot of women don't want to talk about their age. They don't want to talk about menopause or menopause symptoms or side effects of aging, because they feel shameful. They feel like something, they've done something wrong. And yet it's reverse puberty. That's the easiest way to describe it. I've got teenage boys who are like, everything's ramping up. And then, you know, I'm on the other side. And so I like to remind women that there are a lot of things that change physiologically in our bodies. And I think from everything I've read, and certainly correct me if I'm wrong, I think it really kind of starts with this progesterone drifting downward. Yes. As our ovaries are not producing as much progesterone and we're not ovulating every month. And yes, I get women DMing me, they'll say, I still get a period, I'm 54. Well, you're probably ovulating like twice a year, maybe if that. Right. You may be getting a cycle, but you're there. You're knocking on the door of menopause. But I think it's really important for people to understand some of the physiologic, like broad stroke, kind of physiologic things that are happening in our bodies. And it doesn't necessarily just start at 43. It probably at 35, start having these fluctuations. And I really believe, you know, when I was exhausted in my mid 30s and I was telling myself it's because you have a 1-year-old and a 3-year-old and you're chasing after 2 boys, it was probably very likely diminishing progesterone impacting sleep. And I just kind of was making excuses for it. So let's start there. So women can understand, like, what are some of the broad stroke changes that start occurring that impact anxiety, depression, sleep quality, because it really does start that basic. Like, I remind women that sleep is foundational to our health. But I think for many of us, we just kind of go, oh, I'm just, you know, I'm 45 and my sleep's not going to be like it was when I was 20, but it could be, you know, you could have restorative sleep. So let's start there.
Yeah. Yeah. It's such a good question. So, you know, one thing that along this journey that has like baffled me is this term perimenopause, even the term menopause, like, you know, it's like, what is menopause, postmenopause, perimenopause? But when I dove into looking at the history of women's health, we didn't have a term called perimenopause years ago. And we've got women that are going into perimenopause at 35. Mm-hmm. That is not normal. We have women going into menopause at early 40s. Yeah. When I started to dive into the research on menopause, the natural age to go into menopause, which is officially a menopause, like post-menopause, as you've gone a year without your cycle, is somewhere between 52 and 55. Mm-hmm. But we have, I would say, in my experience, I'd be curious what you notice, but in the women that I interact with, we've got like 50% or more going into perimenopause, menopause, late 30s, early 40s. That is not normal. Like, we need to just stop and say that is an environmental cause. Let's figure that out. So when we look at the three hormones, progesterone being the biggest, I mean, progesterone is like, I like one of the chapters I put the title of was "Dear Progesterone, I'm sorry I took you for granted."
Exactly.
Because I literally never thought about her until she was gone. Mm-hmm. And then once progesterone was gone, I was like, wait, why do I feel anxious all the time? Why do I feel like dread? Why do I feel like the world is going to come crashing down on me? And then my brain would go to like everything from my kids. Oh, or how are my kids doing? How's my marriage? How's my relationships? How's my practice? Like, I used to call it my worry scan. Yeah. Like, I would go and just be like, and then the brain would say, everything's okay. Why do I feel this dread? Mm-hmm. And that is the lack of progesterone. So I think starting with that understanding that at 40, progesterone is going to start to make her decline. And it is the hormone. I love Carrie Jones. I have to give her credit for this. She always says it's the hormone that tells you everything's going to be okay.
Yeah.
So if you go into your 40s and you find your brain going, everything's not okay, everything's not okay, then just pause for a moment and try not to think outside of you, because mm-hmm. it would be very easy. Especially, this is the cruelty of menopause, is a lot of our kids become teenagers as we are going deep into menopause. That's rough. So it's easy for us to look outside ourselves and say, well, everything's not okay because of this, and because my husband did this, and my kids are doing this, and the pandemic, and this and that, and politics, and COVID, and mandates, and like, we can just constantly look outside ourselves, but it is an opportunity to go, wait, maybe I'm missing the hormone that calms me in this chaos. So to me, that's where the conversation starts, with helping women understand progesterone and understanding that. Then we can dive into the other hormones.
Well, but I think it's so important. I mean, I am a Western medicine trained NP. I trained at a big research hospital and institution. I arguably would say I got a pretty darn good education, and I knew nothing.
Yes.
About my menstrual cycle, post-pregnancy hormones. I knew nothing about perimenopause, menopause. I knew nothing. I just thought, like, we blissfully go from having babies, and then, you know, 20 years down the road, we worry about menopause. And I just thought everything was balanced up until that point. And I was as surprised as probably any woman that's listening to learn that it's this kind of like, it's like a slow air leak, you know, just
well said.
Yeah. It's like a slow air leak along the way. And it's when, you know, the balloon loses a lot of air that all of a sudden you're like, okay, something's not okay.
Yeah.
So progesterone. So what happens in our bodies when we start losing progesterone? You mentioned some of the emotional and kind of physical symptoms. But I know that we have this nice little backup system. The cruel irony / joke, it's like Mother Nature's ha-ha on us, is, oh, by the way, your adrenals can make some progesterone, yes. But oh, by the way, now you can't handle stress like you did before. So you're going to be constantly stressing these glands that are designed to help our bodies in emergencies. But we're on like emergency backup system all the time.
Yes. Yeah. You know, and this is why if I could get to every 40-year-old woman, mm-hmm. what I would say would be, okay, you're about to go on this slow decline. And the way that I look at it, and I had to reframe it into something really positive, because I spent a lot of years really being angry with how my brain and body were functioning. Mm-hmm. I started to get in touch with, okay, my ovaries have shown up for me. you know, month after month after month, the ovaries have released eggs, you know, however many eggs I had, but two of those eggs turned into two amazing children. And the ovaries are done. At 40, your ovaries are like, I'm out. Yep. And I'm going to just go into retirement. It's going to take me about 10 to 15 years. And in that process, I'm going to hand my job over to the adrenal glands. Mm-hmm. And it's at that moment where the adrenals are like, wait, what? Mm-hmm. Like, we haven't been sleeping. We're raising two children. We're, if you're a working woman, you're like, I've got a job. I've got to come home and make dinner. I've got, you know, you're maybe 15 years into your marriage. You're like, I'm trying to make my marriage work still. And the adrenals are not capable. So if you're not aware of that, as you go through your 40s, it's a wild ride. So the first step is understanding the handoff that's going to happen. And what I've done, and I'd be curious your thoughts on this too, Cynthia, is that what I've done is once I got a hold of progesterone, because like you, I had to go back to the textbooks and like look at like how these hormones were playing out as I was solving my own hormonal picture. But I decided that I needed to create spaces in my week where I said no. So like Friday afternoon and Sunday afternoon, don't invite me anywhere. Like I, for my mental health, need to know if I want to sit on the couch and binge watch, my newest one I'm binge watching is Yellowstone. If you haven't seen Yellowstone, you got to see it. If I want to binge watch Yellowstone or Schitt's Creek, another one I love, at 4 in the afternoon on Friday, I want my schedule cleared to do that. If a girlfriend calls and says, let's go get a drink, I want my schedule cleared to do that. So I cleared from noon on Friday, and I same thing on Sunday. I said, no, that was my spontaneous time. And I slowly started to kind of unwind all the yeses and create some buffers in my week so that I could just calm myself down. That actually really helped. That started to kind of bring some sanity back to my life.
It's interesting. I have always been a just green banana person. And so it's whenever we buy bananas and they come home, I will, you know, enjoy on a day that I've lifted. I'm like, I'll have a, you know, half of a small, like just green banana, but it's literally just turned, you know, from green to yellow. So it has a very different flavor profile, a lot less sugar than, you know, the brown bananas that my husband loves to eat, which I think is a byproduct of the fact that no one else will touch them. But I'm glad to hear you say that, you know, leaning into some of those tropical fruits, obviously portions are important. So yeah. It doesn't mean that you eat five mangoes and a pineapple and a bunch of bananas, but leaning into and kind of intuitively eating, I think this is important. I know not everyone's necessarily at a point where they're able to intuitively eat or intuitively fast, but if you are at that point, you're metabolically healthy. I do encourage people, if it's a higher carb day, you know, lean into those starches that you talked about, just being mindful of portions, depending on, you know, where you are in the metabolic flexibility spectrum.
Yeah. I was on a podcast interview a week ago with it was a sugar addict podcast. And the woman told me that she had been for 90 days eating for her cycle and fasting for her cycle. And that she came in heavier with the carbs I just talked about the week before her period, which would be appropriate for progesterone. And what she noticed was the rest of her cycle, she actually craved carbs less. So I actually have, outside of the microbes idea, my actual gut sense, no pun intended, is that when we actually feed our hormones appropriately, oftentimes the craving goes away. So we definitely have to look at the microbial issue. You know, if you have like candida or something like that, it's going to make you crave it more. But this is your and I, you know, our message that we're trying to get out is eat and fast according to your cycle. And you'd be amazed how some of the things that we have said are genetic or they're normal, or I never can get over this hurdle, are just because you're living out of accordance with your hormones.
I think that's such a good point. I remind people all the time, when you're craving certain types of foods, it's your body's way of telling you you're missing something in your diet. And as the example, there's a lot of us in this low carb ketogenic space. And I have women that will say, well, I'm not supposed to have more than X number of carbs a day. And I'm like, listen, if you allow yourself to have more discretionary carbohydrate in that luteal phase, especially the week before your menstrual cycle, and you adjust your fasting schedule, you are going to have much greater success rather than white knuckling it, which is what I see a lot of women doing. And I always say we don't want to be rigidly dogmatic about anything. I think that is one of the, you know, one of the things that I find personally can be, you know, confusing. I mean, you and I are both clinicians, but for the lay public, when people are, you know, looking to us for information, we are not rigidly dogmatic, and we encourage our patients and clients not to be rigidly dogmatic, because you may go through a period of time where you're doing carnivore-ish, then you may go back to low carb or ketogenic, you may do paleo. I mean, just understanding that our kind of preferences for nutrition can evolve throughout our lifetime. It doesn't have to be just one, you stay in one lane and you never deviate.
Yeah. Yeah. I have come to this conclusion that one of the things we need to embrace as women is that we are rhythmic. We have cycles. Like, you know, as I am starting to enter more into my menopausal time, I'm actually looking at the moon cycle and timing a lot to the moon cycle. And when I go back and I research that, there's a lot of history showing that women, if we didn't have all this blue light, that we would actually all sync up menstrually, our cycles would all sync up with each other and it would be synced to the moon. And so we have a natural ebb and flow. If you look at our personalities in a month period, when you're menstruating, you're going to have times where you're supercharged, your brain feels incredible, and you're going to have, and you feel very social. And then there are other parts of the cycle where you're like, I'm going to sit on the couch here with my sweet potato and my box of Hue chocolate. And I'm going to watch a Netflix series, because that you might shame yourself or say that, you know, you shouldn't be doing that, but certain hormones demand that you do that. And so I think I love this idea of like letting go of the rigidity. We as women are meant to be in flow and we're meant to be in rhythm. It's just that it's a little harder to find that. And so once you start to practice the principles that you and I are teaching, it does, you find your natural flow and it gets much easier.
And I think that's really important. And this is one of the things that I value so much, is that we're both committed to the same population of individuals and women and helping empower them. I jokingly always say, I know more about the menstrual cycle now than I ever did when I was still getting a menstrual cycle, which is really sad and really speaks to the fact that we aren't taught enough about our cycles. And I'm not even sure, you know, I have friends who are GYNs. I'm not even sure they feel like they understand. They understand the textbook, you know, conceptualization of, you know, menstruation, follicular phase, luteal phase, ovulation, et cetera, but on a level that is very kind of, you know, it's in a sense that, you know, they're trying to control, like, oh, if you have short cycles, then we lean this direction. If you have heavy cycles, we lean this direction, without even really understanding that there's likely an imbalance that is driving some of the symptoms that their patients are experiencing. And so I'm grateful that we're talking more about it so that younger generations will be more empowered. They won't feel like there's such a mystery about their evolution through peak fertility, perimenopause, and menopause. And kind of getting back to the cravings piece, I had an interesting question. This young woman said, I'm not sure if it's a bad habit or a craving, but I'm great eating wise for lunch and dinner. Before my window closes, I want treats like chips or sweets. I'm trying to get enough protein at lunch with eggs and chicken with a salad. And then dinner is usually fish or meat with vegetables. I'm not insulin resistant because I just had labs drawn and I only need to lose 5 to 10 pounds. How can I drop those night snacks, or do you have any options for something healthy? So again, leaning into these cravings that we were just talking about.
So let me make sure I understand this. Her big hurdle is she is the night habit.
The night habit, because she's craving salty, sweet stuff after her last meal.
Well, based off of what I heard from her dinner, the first thing I would say is make sure you're getting some good fat in there. Because even just meat and vegetables can often still leave you craving something. So make sure you get some, drizzle some oil on the veggies, like try to get some good fat. The other trick that I've done immediately following dinner is I'll just have like a little square of dark, dark chocolate just to kind of pacify the brain. And then I'll move to like a cup of tea. So that might, if my brain wants something to snack on, I'll move to that. So I think she's got to dial in that dinner with a little more fat to make sure that the next day is going to be a little bit smoother for her. And then she'll lose that 5 to 10 pounds. The second thing, and I know you'll love this one because, and agree with this one. And I'm doing this for myself now that I don't have my kids at home, is eat a little earlier in the evening. If you want to lose that 5 to 10 pounds, you want to make sure that you're eating a little bit earlier. And eating within the sun goes down here at like 6 o'clock. I've been trying to eat my biggest meal, get it over with by 5. And now that's going to take a little more strength when you go into that nighttime snacking. So get yourself some good tea, something that's not going to spike your blood sugar. But if you eat earlier, once melatonin's on the scene, you're more insulin resistant. You could drop 5 to 10 pounds just from that. And then the last thing I'll say is you might throw a longer fast at it. You know, in Fast Like a Girl, I mapped out 6 different lengths, and one of them is the 36-hour fast. And I have found that just if once you've trained yourself to fast, if you can throw one of those 36 hours at it, it can be enough to drop that extra 5 to 10 pounds.
Those are some really good suggestions. What I would add is making sure you've got enough protein in that last meal, because I know if I eat 50 to 60 grams of protein in a meal, I am way too full to be thinking about more eating. I would additionally add, I know that even for myself, if I'm by myself in my house and I'm like, maybe I've got a busy, busy week, I'm thinking of 1,000 things. Sometimes I'm in my pantry and I'm like, what am I doing? So the interruption of that habit. So that's sometimes, you know, it's like 20 degrees. It's like 20 degrees this morning when I got up, but last night I took my dogs for a walk, took them for a walk when I was thinking about something in the pantry that I didn't need to be eating, took them for a walk, and I interrupt that activity. I actually went upstairs and took a bath and went to bed early because yes. I was dealing with some jet lag. So understanding there's definitely different ways that we can address this, but thinking about more fat with your meal, thinking about more protein, understanding that we're more insulin sensitive during the day. And as it gets, you know, here it's like 4:30, 4:45. It's starting to get dark on the East Coast. So understanding that sometimes closing that feeding window a little earlier than normal, and then also considering an extended fast, I think is a really great strategy.
Yeah. Agreed.
Okay. I got a question about electrolytes, which is completely timely. I'm taking a brand with 0 carbs, 0 sugars, and it says it's suitable for fasting. However, it does have a sweet taste. In the book I'm reading, about how any sweet taste spikes insulin, regardless of whether or not it's actually sugar. I'm glad she's making that association. Right. Can you possibly shed some light, as I've been drinking these during my fasting hours, and now I'm not sure if it's breaking my fast?
Yeah. I mean, that in that dilemma, I would get a continuous glucose monitor and know for sure. And if you don't have the financial resources to get the kind that plugs onto your arm, just get a little small one, that you can get at your drugstore or a Keto Mojo. And then I would just make sure that you test the sweetener and find out. We did this in my Resetter collaborative, our free fasting group on Facebook. We did a test, and it was with like tens of thousands of people, and we tested stevia. So I was like, okay, everybody, I just want to see, and this was both men and women, I want to see what happens to stevia with your blood sugar. And I gave them the blood sugar test, test your blood sugar, and then just put some stevia right on your tongue, like without anything, and then test it a half an hour later. There was no consistent certainty. Everybody had something different, had a different response. So, you know, again, we're back to the microbes. They determine your blood sugar. So I think you got to make it personal and do N of one.
Yeah, absolutely. That bio-individuality rules. And it's important for people to understand this whole cephalic phase insulin response. It is very unique. And I do think having a glucometer or a continuous glucose monitor can allow you to see how you're best served. A lot of those products, when it says 0 calories, 0 sugar, they typically have some type of an artificial sugar. And so going back to that non-nutritive sweetener study, we'll make sure we put it in the show notes. Important to understand that specific ones like sucralose, aspartame, even stevia in the context of this particular study impacted the gut microbiome, impacted oral glucose tolerance, which is a totally different test. But just to kind of keep that in mind, that if you're concerned about it breaking your fast, breaking a clean fast, eat it during your feeding window. If you're at all concerned about it, that's an easy way to like not even have to go to those extremes if you don't want to. But I'm a data nerd and I love to test things all the time.
Agreed.
Okay. Let's move on to some hormone questions. What are some good ways? So this is in the context of someone who's still getting a menstrual cycle and has pretty severe PMS. So she has PMDD, which is this premenstrual dysmorphic disorder. What are some good ways to relieve those symptoms? Have you had experience with your patients in PMDD?
Well, the first thing I would say is make sure you're eating enough carbs so that that progesterone can actually make her appearance. The second thing I would say is make sure you're not pushing through, like stressing that week. I mean, these are really like simple kind of basic things. Sometimes I find questions like this, somebody wants the fancy supplement or, you know, the fancy trick, but it really let's go to the foundational more, make sure you're getting that glucose up and then make sure there's not stress isn't high. So that would be the second thing. Magnesium, I would be, if you want the magic supplement for that time of your cycle, it really is magnesium. And actually going back to the stress, I would even take in, like, if you're working out really hard, yoga is an amazing thing. You want to be in recovery that week. And I think this is the biggest thing that I would love to get out to the world, because how many times have we bitched and moaned about like, oh, like I feel horrible. I'm tired. I crave carbs. I want to sit on the couch. It's like, I don't want to talk to anybody. And progesterone's like, yep, that's what we do. And yet we push through that. And so as women have become more in the workplace and having to do work and families, there's this push on through that is not serving us during that week. So make sure you're giving yourself plenty of nurturing, maybe get a massage during that time and up your magnesium, lather yourself in magnesium.
Yeah, such an invaluable response. And I think that it's really important for us as women that white knuckling it, whether it's in a certain time in our menstrual cycle, during fasting, et cetera, that is not what we advocate for. Being kind to yourself is so important. And it's taken me a long time to learn this. It's like, I had to keep learning it over and over again. And I sometimes think about the fact that the times when I had the worst PMS were the times when I was taking the least good care of myself. I'd push through those really hardcore workouts. I would be going really low carb. I mean, I just didn't know any better. Obviously now I do. I wasn't getting my sleep that I needed. I wasn't saying no enough. So when you're dealing with significant PMS, really understanding that is the time your body is really encouraging you to slow down, lean into some more carbohydrates, be more gentle. That's not the time to be doing these crazy fasts, you know, maybe 12 hours of digestive rest. I love that answer. And magnesium, I always say everyone needs more magnesium in their life.
Yeah. And the other thing that I've been thinking about lately that we don't talk enough about as women is that what is the action of your period? Like when you shed blood, it's actually a bit of a detox. It can detox toxins. It can detox emotions. So if there's any point in our cycle where we have got to take better care of ourselves, it's during that time. And when we look at PMDD and we look at, you know, other hormonal situations, even PCOS, infertility, like we really have to get to know where our behaviors have to change at different points of our cycle. And then honoring that menstruation. I loved what you said about like, I almost wish I had a cycle again. Like I, now that I understand it at 53, I'm like, sheesh, I wish I understood it at 33. Like I understand it now. But it's really that, you know, in the book, I call this the nurture phase, that week before we need to nurture ourselves.
No, it's such a good point. And I think every woman listening needs to lean into nurturing themselves more. Yeah. There are very few people I meet that nurture themselves enough, really and truly. And I say that from the most loving perspective, myself included. I'm a work in progress. Yes. Okay.
Well said.
Another progesterone question as it relates to perimenopause. This young woman says, I'm 50. I still have a regular period, but that week before my period, when I pause my intermittent fasting, I feel very anxious and annoyed with everyone. I just bought progesterone cream and used it the week before my last period, but I'm wondering if I should be using it throughout the month. Thank you for everything you do for women's health. You and Cynthia are my gurus.
Oh, I love it. Well, yeah, anxiety at that time of your period is definitely low progesterone. So as far as the progesterone cream, that's really a question for your doctor. I think the big thing on any kind of creams or bioidenticals is there's an art to mastering it for you. So I think one of the misconceptions is I'll just rub some cream on myself. I'll give you a story about progesterone cream that I did as a 53-year-old woman. As I test this, all this stuff out on my own, and I put progesterone cream on this summer, I still was having a bit of a cycle this summer, and I literally went crazy. I was like, everybody was agitating me. My kids had come over. I was not kind to them, which I apologized a bit later, and I couldn't understand what was going on with me. And what I figured out was that at 53, I have low estrogen too. So when I rubbed the progesterone cream on me, it took estrogen even lower, which my ability to handle stress became even more difficult. So I think for this woman at 50, we've got to, you know, you find a good practitioner can help you with dosing that. But again, I would go back into everything we've said about progesterone, soften that week and up, you know, make sure you're eating more carbs and the magnesium. Like, it's really about slowing down, which is probably the hardest thing to do.
Absolutely. And such a good response. You know, I would add to that bioindividuality rules, you know, definitely have a conversation with your medical provider. Get your hormones tested. This is one thing that I really encourage women to do. Nothing makes me more angry. This is tangentially, I'm just going to say this one thing, because I know you appreciate this, Mindy. A woman said to me recently, my doctor told me I don't need to check my hormones because I'm in menopause. And I said, you need a new provider. Like, that was my standard refrain. So knowledge is power. Work with someone that's going to work concurrently with you, work as a team so that you get the information that you need. I do find for younger women, sometimes that progesterone cream, if needed, can be helpful that week before.
Agreed.
I do think for other women, they may need oral progesterone if that's what they're interested in doing. And you would obviously want to make sure that you're working with your provider, but I would get tested, because the fact that you had this exacerbation of just being irritated, much to Mindy's point, if you're at the tail end of perimenopause, your estrogen levels are probably pretty low to begin with. And it would really be a value to know exactly where you are, get your labs tested, work with someone that will consider all the options that are available to you.
Well said.
Okay. I need some clarification. I'm still foggy with perimenopause and fasting for my cycle. If I don't fast the week of my expected cycle and then my period does not start, do I keep a 12-hour fasting window until my period starts? What if I skip and cycle completely? I want to work with my cycle, but in a season of unpredictability, I am not able to get into a good rhythm. I typically have a 30 to 35 day cycle, and I would like to do a 16-8 at least 2 to 3 days per week.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. So the perimenopausal woman, you know, we've been there, we get it, and it's hard, and it's probably the hardest category age range to explain how to eat and fast because there's no predictability. So here's what I say is a couple of things. You want to get to know the personalities of your hormones. And this is how I look at it, is that when I would all of a sudden, like I'm actually 90 days into no cycle. And so what I, you know, I don't have anything to map it to. So I usually go, okay, if I'm anxious, I didn't sleep well, and low back pain is one that shows up for me with progesterone. I go, okay, and I'm hungry in the morning. Those are signs that I need to feed progesterone. So I won't fast that day, or I won't fast as long, and I'll lean into more foods like we've talked about. When my skin is really dry, and mucosal membranes are really dry, my brain can't hold on to information, that's when I'm like, ooh, I need more estrogen. Okay, estrogen likes me to fast and likes me to go into more of a keto diet. So I use their symptoms that they give me to help myself understand that. The other thing is, again, I'm back at the moon cycle. This woman could just chart her cycle according, start when, you know, the new moon's on day one, you could go around that. And then the last one is that I'm actually having some perimenopausal women do ovulation kits, because, which is so silly, but this woman, what she could do is, you know, do honor that week before her cycle. So I think she said you had a 34 day.
Yeah.
So
30 to 35 days.
Yeah. So make sure you're eating more carbs and you're not fasting. And then at 35, the 35th day, go back into more of your fasting, more of your keto. And then maybe 10 days after that, do an ovulation, test. You can get them really cheaply off of Amazon and see if you're ovulating at that point. So you almost kind of have to make your own cycle up, which is why I like the moon or I like the ovulation kit. Otherwise you got to get to know the personalities.
Yeah, that's such a great way of thinking about it, Mindy. It's funny. I had pretty regular cycles till maybe the last 2 years before I was hospitalized in 2019. And I remember being so frustrated when you think you're going to get your cycle and then it doesn't start. Yeah. And so I completely understand how frustrating that is, but you really gave us some good tips.
Well, and it's interesting in your book, you mentioned rushing woman syndrome. And so that so spoke to me because irrespective of who you are and what age you are, we are all guilty of this and how brilliant it is to say, I'm creating boundaries in my personal life to do the things energetically I need to do so that I can relax, be present, and really kind of take an opportunity to tap into that side of our autonomic nervous system that doesn't get enough respect, the parasympathetic rest and repose side. And unfortunately, we're in a culture that really doesn't value downtime for the most part, really doesn't value people saying no. And especially for reformed people pleasers, and I'm handing my hand up for those of you that can't see me, that has been life changing. And I think that in many ways, if you're listening to this podcast and thinking, oh yeah, I'm the rushing woman syndrome where I'm on the go, feel over obligated, but maybe that works for you in your 20s and 30s, but in your 40s, and certainly perimenopausal age range will effectively determine, I think, how you're going to either survive or thrive in middle age. And I see so many women. There was a neighborhood that we left last year. We sold our house in a day and moved into a rental, and now we're finally settled again. But there were women in that neighborhood. Every time they're up running 5 to 8 miles every morning, and they just looked haggard. Yep. And I was like, that is the worst thing you can do to your body at this stage of the game. Unfortunately, as much as you may enjoy the runner's high, it's, you know, bumping up your cortisol, it's stressing your adrenals more. Yep. Yep. And what I found interesting when I was kind of preparing for our podcast together, and this won't surprise you at all, there was a New England Journal of Medicine article, and it was expressing concern over the fact that the newest generation of internal medicine primary care providers lacked the training to manage menopause symptoms. So this is why it's so critically important that we as women empower ourselves, get educated, get informed. And, you know, in some instances, you may have to break up with the person you're working with, and that's okay. But you need to align yourself with healthcare professionals that are going to make a lot of the lifestyle medicine recommendations that we're going to be talking about.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's a couple of things I want to highlight in that. The first is, this is why we have to have conversations like this. We have to normalize the messiness of menopause. That's the first thing. So as you're listening to this, like if you resonate with it, I want to create a culture where women can be vulnerable and strong at the same time. Just because you're really struggling through menopause mentally, maybe physically, there are resources to help you. And it's okay to say, as a powerful woman, I need help or I need emotional support. And I think if we as women sort of take back this menopause term and say, some days you might see me happy and cheery, and other days I may call you crying and I don't understand why. And we need to surround ourselves with women that are able to have that conversation with each other, so that we, as we move through it, that's really the first thing. The second is, I had the New England Journal of Medicine's point, this is what happened to me when I went, and I tell the story in the menopause reset, when I went to this doctor and we just happened to both be moms sitting at a science fair. I don't know about you, Cynthia, but I try not to talk shop. Like when I'm in mommy mode, I'm like, I'm in mommy mode. I'm here as a mom, but I was struggling so deeply. And we were staring at this science experiment, and she was a well-respected OB in our community. And I was desperate. And when I turned to her and said, hey, what can I do? Help me. And she said, I don't know. My medical textbooks have failed me. What that did in that moment is it gave me permission to find my own journey. It was actually as like shocking as her her comment was. What on the whole ride home, I was like, if Heidi doesn't know, holy schmoly, who's going to help me? And that's when I started to dive into it. And that, you know, the menopause reset, what I realized is, okay, there's a lifestyle that needs to change here. I truly believe that the happiest lives come from building it from the inside out and always working on the inner you, whether it's spiritual, mental, or physical, and start there instead of grasping for things outside of us. You know, we talked about how many, and I still think about this, like how many divorces happen to women as they go through menopause. The inside of them is not feeling good, yet they're pointing to the outside. So is swapping your husband out going to be the solution? I've been married, oh God, I don't even know how many years now. He always keeps track. It's like 26, something like that.
Wow. That's
amazing. There's like lots of iterations of marriage. We're empty nesters now, and I'm more in love with him now than I've ever been. And I think, oh, I'm so happy my menopausal brain didn't let me go down the road of blaming my struggles mentally because of my lack of hormones on him. So this is why we got to highlight the conversation so that we can understand ourselves, but also we can normalize this craziness we go through.
Well, and I think so many of us are on autopilot that we're not really connecting with other people. Now, like, let's take the pandemic out of this, but even preceding the pandemic, how many parties you've been to and you're having superficial conversations. And so I was actually saying to, you know, one of my dearest and best friends from graduate school, who's like a sister I never had. And I was saying, I'm so grateful. Like two of my closest friends from grad school are 10 years older. So they went through menopause way before I did. And they're like, good for you for talking openly about it. Like we felt so much shame that we just kind of, and these are nurse practitioners. They're like literally suffered in silence. And they just said, you know, what was our alternative? And I said, it's hard for me to imagine. I mean, I know when I was really in the thick of perimenopause, just purely coincidentally, my yearly exam with my GYN was scheduled and my period started that day. And I had been telling her, my periods are very heavy. And so she did an internal exam and her first statement was, oh my God, your periods are really heavy. And I said, I've been telling you this. And before she could even say, let's talk about liver detoxification and dietary choices and lifestyle, it was, let's put you on the pill.
Right.
Then it was, let's put an, if that doesn't work for you, you don't want to take a pill every day, I get it. Let's put an IUD in. Then it was, if you don't like that idea, then let's do an ablation. And if you really want to be rid of this problem, honest to God, let's just do a hysterectomy. And I was like, no, and no. I was like, there has to be a better way. She's like, but your periods are so heavy. And I said, my periods are this heavy because of where I am in time and space. So as progesterone, this is my segue, as progesterone starts to wax and wane, we get this relative estrogen dominance. And this is oftentimes manifested in very heavy menstrual cycles, clotting, cramping, maybe your breasts are tender, maybe you've gained weight, maybe your sleep is further disrupted. And so at this stage, obviously you're hoping that you have the ability to articulate what you're feeling, because what you're feeling is fat and frumpy. There's no other way around it. I remember saying to my good friend, I said, I don't know how else to describe it, except I don't feel like myself. And I'm not used to feeling fat and frumpy. I've never felt frumpy in my life. And I feel very frumpy. And so talk about not wanting to connect with your partner, talk about not wanting to, you know, do fun things that you normally would have otherwise done without reservation. And so I think this can further isolate women, not only from themselves, but from their significant others and their friends and their family. So when they're in this estrogen dominant kind of state, what are some of the things that you will talk to your patients about? What are some of the things you emphasize for them to be focusing on instead of the four alternatives that were offered to me that I said no to?
Yeah. Yeah. And thank God you said no, you know, I mean, it's trying to kill that symptom at the cost of the 70-year-old version of you that we want to be healthy and disease-free. I think that's the real message, is that sometimes in the discomfort, we just want to throw something at it. But if we can work with the lifestyle part of this, then the 70-year-old version of you, the 80-year-old version of you can thrive. And that's, for me, what I'm always thinking down the road at my future self. So in the menopause reset, I really put out five things and that I think need to change for women. And I can briefly go through them. I've been thinking lately about a sixth thing that we'll talk about that's sort of coming out. But the five things, the way I would do it, if I had every 40-year-old woman that I could just tap on the back and be like, hey, you're 40 now, you got to change these five things. Like, lifestyle has to change. So that would be like I actually, this, I'm going to digress for a second, but I have decided that at 40, I want every woman to get a copy of the Menopause Reset, not for my own selfish needs, but because I want women to change their lifestyle. At 50, you know what women need at 50? I should have given it to you because you just turned 50. Do you know what a V-fit is?
No.
Oh my God, it's red light therapy. This is totally off topic, but every 50-year-old woman needs to know it. It's red light therapy for inside your vaginal area.
Wow.
And it repairs the mucosal lining inside the vaginal area. Which... and it actually can start to get like estrogen producing again. Like, it can balance your hormones. Anyways, totally now, different topic.
Which we need. So whether listeners know this or not, when we lose estrogen throughout our body, including our, you know, vaginal microbiome, it impacts these healthy, and I know you talk a little bit about this, it impacts healthy probiotics in the vaginal microbiome, and they kind of die off. It's kind of like the fertilizer is the estrogen, and when the estrogen goes, so do they, which contributes to all the vaginal symptoms that no one wants to even think about. And so I can imagine why that would be an incredibly useful, useful tool on many, many levels. And certainly if listeners are interested in having us unpack vaginal stuff, we can definitely go there as well. So let's talk about these.
Yeah. So anyway, so let's go back. I just had to make sure, as your friend, I had to make sure you knew about
that. I appreciate that. I appreciate it. I'm writing it down right now.
Yeah, it's amazing. Okay, so here are the five things. And as those hormones, what's going to happen is progesterone's going to decline and estrogen's going to get out of control. Mm-hmm. So you're going to have days where estrogen's high. You'll have days where estrogen's low. You'll know it because your hair is going to go out of control. I can tell you, as a curly headed woman, that some days I have like an afro and other days it's like stick straight, and it's all because of estrogen coming and going. So the five things are, first, you're going to find that as estrogen does her thing, you're going to be more insulin resistant. Mm-hmm. So you and I have a passion for fasting. This is like, if a woman isn't fasting by 40, she needs to fast. And you're going to have to compress that eating window. You're going to need more time to regulate the insulin and glucose. What you ate at 41 is going to put on more weight than what you ate at 31. Same meal, as estrogen makes her decline, you're going to notice the weight. So fasting's number one. The second is, I believe that we've got to do variations of keto. Now, I think keto is great at certain moments and it's not so good at other moments. So this was kind of my big aha through this whole experience for myself, is that when you start to look at just estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone, you realize that we were actually not meant to eat the same foods all throughout the whole month. Why aren't we teaching 13-year-olds that?
No.
It's crazy. So when estrogen loves keto, you can be insulin sensitive. You can go into your keto. You can go into longer fasts at the beginning of your cycle. You and I have talked about this. Like, estrogen loves keto. Progesterone doesn't want keto. Progesterone wants you to sit on the couch and have a tub of ice cream and a box of pizza. But we don't want you to do that either. We want to maybe swap that out for some better carbohydrates. So we start to look in our 40s at what hormone do I need? What food can I use to match that hormone? Then the third one is the microbiome. So, and so many women, oh my gosh, like rounds of antibiotics, decades of birth control, and they have no diversity in their microbiome. Well, just because you make estrogen, just because you make progesterone, doesn't mean you break it down. You've got to make the hormone, you've got to break the hormone down, and you've got to have cells that can use the hormone. So it's the microbiome that's going to break those hormones down. So what are you eating? Are you eating the same foods over and over again? When you make a salad, are you always doing romaine lettuce with Caesar dressing? Or do you put, like, I love putting mint and basil and parsley and microgreens. Like, you got to open your foods up. I do, like, chicken and beef and goat and bison and all different kinds of fish and duck eggs and chicken. Like, I'm constantly trying to open up the variation of foods I eat to feed my microbiome so it breaks the little bit of estrogen and progesterone I'm getting at 52. Like, it breaks that down. So really pay attention to your microbiome. The fourth is toxins. You know, the and this is a hard one. Let's use lipstick as an example. The lipstick you put on at 30 that has lead in it, you may have not noticed it. At 50, it could be building you cancer. So we've got to swap out our beauty products, make sure we're doing natural beauty products. We've got to look at our household cleaners. Like, we got to dive in and start to look at our toxic load. As estrogen's doing its up and down and is kind of crazy, a lot of toxins come out of stored tissues and they go up into the hypothalamus and pituitary and they start to mess with our hormones even more. And then the last piece is what you said, and I didn't coin that term. You got to bring Libby Weaver on. You got to bring her on. She's just, I love this woman because she wrote a book called The Rushing Woman Syndrome, and it's the biochemistry behind what happens when we rush. And I will tell you, as a strong woman, my mom taught me, you're a woman, you can do whatever you want. But what she forgot to say was, except when you go through menopause, you're going to need to chill out a little bit because the rushing woman does not thrive in menopause. So I had to unwind and learn the things we talked about in the beginning and say no to more. And another part of the rushing woman that I think is really important is surround yourself with women that are okay when you say no. So, like, my closest friends, you know, if they want to invite me somewhere and I'm overrushed that week and I say, sorry, guys, I'm going to sit on the couch, I just need to rejuvenate, they get it. Mm-hmm. As opposed to women going, come on, let's go. Don't be a loser. Don't be a downer. Like, let's go do this. Like, we need to just, this to me, 40 is where we should just start to nurture each other in making these lifestyle changes.
Yeah, no, it's so beautifully stated. And the lifestyle aspects that you addressed are really the most important. I unfortunately, as a traditionally Western medicine trained nurse practitioner, I always say we need everyone. We need the traditionally trained, the integrative medicine trained, we need them all. But when it comes to kind of proactively looking at how to deal with the problem, and I'm putting in quotes, the problem that is menopause, the first place to start is not with hormones. It's not to suggest that there might be a place for someone in that whole milieu, but the lifestyle stuff you have to start with. It's much, much harder. I mean, I say this probably every single day in groups, with one-on-ones, on social media. Say it is much harder to say no, to set boundaries, to change your diet, to not eat as often. That is much, much harder work than just getting a prescription for medication, which is not to suggest that there isn't value for people that need prescription medications. I'm not suggesting that at all. But how many women come to me, probably come to you, And, you know, they go through menopause and they get put on a bunch of hormones and their body's not ready to process said hormones properly. And they end up putting on a bunch of weight and then they're even more depressed. And so they come to you, they're mad that they've gained weight, they're tired, they can't sleep, they're on hormones and they haven't done any of the other work. And so I always say we have to do the foundational work. Yeah. And one thing that you touched on, and I want to touch on a very ugly word that I know we both have laughed about before, the estrobolome. So when we're talking about diversity of gut bacteria and we're talking about estrogen, we would be remiss if we didn't talk about this ugly terminology for how our body can break down, detoxify, and get rid of estrogen. And I think there's this misnomer that everyone, just because they poop every day, they're getting rid of estrogen. And this is such a misunderstood concept. Like, I have women that are like, you don't understand, how could my beta glucuronidase be high? Why, how is my phase one and phase two liver detoxification not optimized? I poop every day. And I'm like, cause you're recirculating all the estrogen. Yeah. And so let's at least talk about this oddly termed.
I know, right? What do we, I call it the estrobolome, and then I hear other people call it something different. So it's kind of like autophagy, autophagy, like whatever floats your boat, say it that way.
Tomato.
Right, exactly. You know, when I was trying to put my own puzzle together, I started with those three hormones. So, and we definitely need to talk about testosterone because that's another one that doesn't get enough attention. So I literally started with progesterone, trying to understand her. And then I understood, okay, I need to keep my adrenals in good shape to keep progesterone up. Okay, I get that. Now, estrogen, what do I need to understand about estrogen? And that's when I dove into understanding the estrobolome. And that, like, if you think about it, how many women have you sat with that have been on 20, 30 rounds of antibiotics? One round of antibiotic destroys 90% of your good bacteria, including the bacteria that are going to break estrogen down. So if you have not done any microbiome repair and you go running into menopause, whew, that's going to be a hard one because you've got to bring that microbiome back so that it can break estrogen down. And luckily, bringing the microbiome back is actually can be pretty quick. Those bacteria can replicate. So I always tell people, like I said, improve your diversity of food. Look at what I call the three P's, your polyphenol, probiotic, prebiotic foods. My favorite thing to remind women is the 40s is when you need to start to bathe in sauerkraut. Like, more sauerkraut, more kimchi. Mm-hmm. And when women are like, I don't really like those. They don't taste good. I always say, you know what? When you were in college, you would do shots of tequila. Did you like those shots of tequila? Like, most of us didn't, but we did it to have an effect on our body. Right. I'm thinking that sauerkraut might be the same. Like, if you don't like the taste of it, eat it anyways, because it brings this good bacteria back into your gut, and that's going to help you break down estrogen. So to me, the estrobolome needs to be nurtured. It needs to be fed. Your microbiome is like a little pet that, you know, when you sit down and you stroke your dog, you feel calm. Well, that pet is inside your gut. So when you eat a cup of sauerkraut and maybe some, you know, put some chia seeds and hemp seeds on your salad, you are starting to repopulate that microbiome, and you're going to get more GABA, you're going to get more serotonin, your immune system, you're going to break down estrogen, you'll start feeling different just by a food choice that supports that microbiome.
You know, I think there are a lot of limiting beliefs about women. You know, men obviously go through andropause, but I think there's so many limiting beliefs. I mean, I look at my grandmothers when they were in their 50s, and I look at most of my girlfriends who are late 40s, early 50s, and I'm like, wow, it's a different mindset. I think people are not quite as accepting of, you know, I turn a certain age and therefore I have to accept these things. And so one of my kind of standard mantras is I don't accept weight gain as a normal function of aging. Nope. Because I think weight gain is a reflection of so many things, so many imbalances, you know, whether it's hormones, lifestyle, et cetera. And so I always say, if we can get things better balanced, if we can find a system or a set of strategies that are effective, and I love that you say exercises for mental health, because that was what I did. I mean, everyone in my family thought I was nuts. it didn't matter how cold it was outside, you know, March, April, May, I went out in my winter coats with my two dogs.
And awesome.
I'd walk for five miles every day because it was the only thing I could do.
Yep. Yeah. And whereas so like, did you ever do that where you like would beat yourself up? Like, oh, I didn't run as hard as I wanted to mm-hmm. today. I didn't, you know, and testosterone starts to decline in your 40s mm-hmm. too. So as testosterone tanks, your motivation for working out really changes. Mm-hmm. So I found myself like pushing yeah. to do the old way I used to work out. Mm-hmm. But then when I came to fasting, it changed my whole relationship yeah. to working out. It was so cool.
And I think forcing outcomes is something that I seem to have to let mindset shift for a lot of women in particular. I'm like, anything you have to force, don't do. Like yeah. I find for myself, like I just took 2 or 3 weeks off from lifting because I just was in a position where I was like, we were changing gym memberships. And I was like, do we really want a gym membership? We've got a home gym. Do I want to just do solid core classes, which I'm really loving, which is really tough, but it's a different way of working my muscles. And I just said, I think I'm in this pivoting point of my life where I'm just trying to figure out like, what do I want to do now? I'm not forcing myself to do any type of exercise. It's like, awesome. Are there some days I don't do anything? Yeah. And that's okay. Yeah. And I yeah. think we just have to give ourselves grace and not beat ourselves yep. up. But I find for many, many women, they want intermittent fasting to be the magic bullet. And I have to remind them there are a lot of different reasons why it may not work as yep. an effective weight loss strategy. And so we have to dig a little deeper. So let's dive into ketosis and ketogenic diets, because I think there's a lot of misinformation, a lot of, the best example I can give you is that I see a lot of people, they think I'm eating keto, so I'm going to eat 5 pounds of pork a day, and I'm going to have, you know, 5 avocados, and I'm going to have, you know, 2 blocks of cheese. And I'm like, no, that's not the right way to do keto. So
right.
how do we do keto effectively? How does that impact the results we can get with intermittent fasting and ultimately impact weight gain in a positive way?
Yeah, I think the first thing is that if you're going to go from intermittent fasting to keto, I really encourage people to get a blood sugar reader mm-hmm. because the blood sugar and the ketone reader it's such a better measurement of what your body is doing with food mm-hmm. than the scale. Mm-hmm. My scale broke about 4 years ago and I decided I'm not getting a new one. I'm going to turn to the blood sugar reader to see mm-hmm. how that is working for me. And so if you're going to do keto, the blood sugar reader is really powerful. The second thing is when we go keto, there's a couple of things for women that they need to think about, but especially the perimenopause woman. In the keto world, there is a tendency to go, oh, I'm going to completely give up carbs, like you said, and they ignore, and then they go overdo it on protein or they overdo it on fat. There is, and that's not what we're looking for. We're back at extremes. We want to create a lifestyle where your body can ride this hormonal ups and downs very effortlessly. So I recommend something what I call keto biotic, where people are not bringing their carbs down to like 10 and 20 grams. They're doing 50, mm-hmm. keep it around 50 net carbs. And when you eat a carb, make sure it's coming from greens. Make sure mm-hmm. it's coming from vegetables. Add in some, and I call it biotic because we're huge fans of sauerkraut and kimchi. Mm-hmm. And what are you doing to feed your microbiome? Like you have a whole set of bacteria in your gut called the estrobilome mm-hmm. that break down estrogen. So if you decide to go low keto, high carb, or high protein, what's going on for the microbiome? How are we supporting the microbiome that breaks down estrogen? So that's kind of the first couple of things that I look at. I find a lot of women who go intermittent fast, do keto, and still struggle to lose weight are doing too much protein or too much fat and not caring for their microbiome enough. So that's why I like more of a ketobiotic approach to keto. Now, having said all of that, for the perimenopause woman who still has a cycle, there is one time of her month, or let's call it her 60-day period, whatever it decides to show up, that she absolutely should not be keto. And that is right before she's about to shed, like right before mm-hmm. she bleeds. Typically, this would be at day 21, and you need progesterone then. Mm-hmm. And how you make progesterone is by eating things like beans and squashes and citrus fruits, tropical fruits. Grass-fed beef will do it, but potatoes are great for progesterone. So what I find with a lot of women is that they try intermittent fasting first. They get a good little break, a good little result there. Then they go to keto and they go low keto and they don't think about their cycle. And that's where we start to get in trouble. They're too low in the carbs, too high in the protein, too high in the fat. And they're trying these extremes when the body's trying to make progesterone. And now the result is nothing. And in fact, it usually increases anxiety, creates more spotting because progesterone is what allows that uterine, the lining of the uterus to shed. Mm-hmm. They get worse menopause symptoms. And now they're like, keto didn't work for me.
Right. Oh, and they can't sleep. That's a big thing.
Hot flashes.
Yep. Yeah. Absolutely. But I love that you encourage women, you know, in that premenstrual phase to up their carbs, because it's something that I've come to find if they've got enough carb variation or carb cycling that week, they don't have as many food cravings. They're not craving chocolate or sweets or other things. And if you're giving your body really high quality carbohydrates, you know, not the cakes and cookies and dark chocolate kind of things, that all of a sudden your blood sugar is better balanced. You're going to sleep better. I think this is really, really critical and such valuable information. Now, do you find that women, once they've made the transition into menopause, that do you encourage them to cycle carbohydrates or to change things up? How does that kind of factor in for you?
That's a great question. Once you're beyond menopause, then you just need to think and realize that you have very little estrogen and progesterone, and those are protective hormones. So the way that we get estrogen and progesterone is through a higher carb diet. Mm-hmm. So you're going to need to splash in what I call hormone building days, where you step out of ketosis. Mm-hmm. Usually I tell postmenopausal women it can be once a week or every couple of weeks, throw a 2 or 3 day period where you step out mm-hmm. and you lean into the foods that I mentioned, where you're trying to build hormones. And what I find is, you know, I'm sure you see this with your people, that it's weird how people can be postmenopausal, but they still have all the symptoms of menopause.
Yes.
And so the same rules apply. You just don't have a cycle that you're going to focus on these hormone building. Mm-hmm. So it's the in and out of these different scenarios that make or different phases of eating that will make all the difference. Mm-hmm. But we live in a culture that says, give me one diet.
Yeah.
I want the one diet and the one fast, and now I'm good to go.
Yeah. Right.
But it doesn't work like that. We are meant to have variation. If you go back to the caveman days, mm-hmm. they had in the winter, they were meant to go into ketosis because they were in the cave and they didn't have access to food. So they had a way of making ketones so that they could stay alive. Mm-hmm. But then in the summertime, they had tons of access to food, longer days. So we were not meant to do the same day, same style over and over again.
I could not agree more. Much like I remind my clients that we don't want to do the same exercise single day. Our bodies get adapted. I said, once you're fat adapted, once you're, you know, using ketones for energy, that's the time that you need to start cycling or transitioning or, you know, creating variation, just like you wouldn't do, for example, 16-8 for the rest of your life. You know, you're going to have days where you're going to have more calories, and it could come from, and I hate to use the calories, more macros, either from protein or carbohydrates, or you're going to have more days where maybe you're doing a longer fast. And I think that's really critical that our bodies adapt best. We talk about that term hermetic stressors, mm-hmm. that we do things to stress the body in beneficial ways. And there's definitely too much of any one thing is not good. So I remind people,
absolutely,
over exercising, under sleeping, not enough variation in your fasting schedule, or being really rigid. Like, I'm not a fan of rigidity. There's very little in life we have to be rigid about.
Yep.
But, you know, definitely as it pertains to nutrition and pertains to fasting schedules, I think we have to give ourselves, I always use the term, give ourselves some grace.
Absolutely.
Celebrations. Every once in a while, you may have a glass of alcohol. Although if you're perimenopausal or menopausal, you'll realize if you have that glass of alcohol, you may suddenly get some hot flashes or not sleep as well. That's why I rarely, if ever, drink, because it just isn't worth it. My sleep is too precious.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. And I would agree. And I think this is what I see in my community. It's, I want to honor the fact that it's very difficult, because then it gets confusing. Mm-hmm. So it's easier for me to stand here or to get onto a podcast and say, keto, intermittent fasting, it will solve all your problems. Mm-hmm. And then that's all you do. It just doesn't work like that. We have to learn to vary it. Mm-hmm. So I always tell people to start with intermittent fasting, learn how to get into ketosis. Mm-hmm. Now, once you're there, let's teach you how to do some of these, this what I call feasting. Mm-hmm. Let's do it healthy. Feasting doesn't mean you eat whatever the heck you want. Feasting means, okay, let me eat foods that I know are going to maybe build me muscle. Like you could feast on protein. You could do carnivore one day and decide I'm going to mega dose on protein to build muscle. Mm-hmm. Or one day you could feast and do, I'm going to build up my progesterone. I'm going to do chili with some potatoes. Mm-hmm. But we become zealots for one nutritional style of eating. We even walk around and say, I'm ketogenic. I you know, we like label ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it's not serving us.
Yeah, it's such a good point. And I think when we're rigid in our dogma as it pertains to labels, we lose out on opportunities to try new things. I'm very open about last year. I had a very long hospitalization. Never underestimate the power of a ruptured appendix. I remember when I came out, I couldn't do paleo. My gut only tolerated meat. I did carnivore for months and months and months. I had sworn I would never do just carnivore. And it was actually something that helped heal my gut. So I like to be very upfront and say, now I'm kind of carnivore-ish, because that still works really well for my body. But if we remain rigid to dogma or perspectives, we'll miss out on opportunities to, you know, experience things that could be profoundly beneficial. Now, I love that you kind of talked on detoxification, detox. And so obviously some people will do a lower carb diet, they'll do intermittent fasting, they're still not losing weight. And so what are some of the reasons why that can happen? I know that I always say people get tired of me just saying this, because your healthcare provider can be hugely beneficial. What are some of the other reasons you sometimes see women stuck? You know, they're not getting weight, they're not getting the results they want.
Yeah. So again, let's go back to, like, I like to step things out. Like, okay, so we're going to assume that this person that is stuck understands that they may be over-exercising. They may be too stressed out. When the body's in stress, it will not drop weight. Like you said, if you don't sleep, you can't lose weight. If you're stressed all the time, the body will not drop weight. So managing stress becomes really important. And I've seen a lot of women over-exercise, it seems, and they start to gain weight. So then you learn how to fast, which is great. Maybe you start with 15 hours a day. Then you add in keto and you start to understand the keto variation, and you're still not losing weight. Mm-hmm. So there are a couple of options at that point. One is, like you said before, sometimes you're going to have to force your body to adapt even more. You're going to have to put your body into a place where you're almost like forcing it to become a fat burner. Mm-hmm. And you can do that through longer fasting. So my favorite fast for women that are stuck and can't lose weight is the 36-hour fast. Throw in every week, every couple of weeks, a 36-hour fast and see if that unsticks your body's ability to go find the glucose and the insulin and the toxins that you've stored in fat. Mm-hmm. You need to force it to go find that. The second thing, if you're like, well, I mean, we have people in our resetter group that are like, I've done 5-day fasts and I've only lost 1 pound.
Wow.
Then you're now looking at a toxic issue. Mm-hmm. So remember that the brain has to know that the fat is there for it to burn. Mm-hmm. And it does that by communicating via hormones. And the fat burning hormone that you want to tap into is leptin. Mm-hmm. And leptin has a receptor site on the outside of the fat cells that where it can send this hormone back and forth to the brain. But if those fat cells are packed with endocrine disruptors and heavy metals and glyphosate and all the toxins we're seeing in our environment right now, and your hypothalamus pituitary, which controls hormones, all hormonal connection, has toxins in it. It's like taking two toxic people in a relationship that aren't communicating well with each other. So that's where once all those other steps are not working, you got to detox. You got to look at getting into some type of detox, which will remove those interferences to the fat burning capabilities mm-hmm. of your body.
And I think it's important for people to understand that our body ideally uses detoxification in many ways. So we breathe, we sweat, we poop, we pee. Our liver is intricately involved in detoxification. But as Dr. Mindy said, there are so many things, environment, personal care products, and food that can kind of muck this up. And we think about chemicals we're exposed to. And this is why I think it's so valuable for people to really look at their personal care products. And I always say, you know, if you can do nothing else, change your deodorant, change the lotion or the soap you use, and change what you wash your face with, like three things that may take a little time to find the right deodorant for you. But the point being, there are definitely ways you can do that are going to limit your toxin exposure. And like in my house, I've been buying, you know, cloth covered hangers for the last couple of months. My family thinks I'm nuts because I kept saying, we have so many plastic hangers. And my kids were like, I don't understand why this is important. And I said, plastics in our life should really be limited. Like as much as we can, little changes. And obviously most people can't do everything all at once. It makes their head spin out. But I think it's really, really important to just be aware of what's in our environment that can make us, you know, make our bodies not work very efficiently. And if you have a lot of adipose tissue, a lot of fat to lose, those toxins stay stored. Your body does it to protect you, as frustrating as it is.
Yes.
Really frustrating. But that leptin resistance, that lack of communication between leptin and your brain is what can cause you to overeat, and your body's trying to protect all this. And I'm probably oversimplifying it, but it can actually make it harder to tap into these things. So you really have to do the due diligence. And this is obviously for people who still feel like they're stuck. They're not, you know, maybe they're not, their best friend lost 15 pounds intermittent fasting, their husband lost 20 and they've lost zero.
Yeah. And they're so frustrated. And then they say it's the diet or they beat themselves mm-hmm. up. I really want to relieve women of that, mm-hmm. that kind of thinking. You said something that I just want to point out that does not get talked about enough. And I tell my resetters to do this. If you want to know how to lose weight, the next time you look at yourself in the mirror, I want you to thank your fat mm-hmm. because your fat, the reason that you are accumulating fat is because it's excess storage mm-hmm. for glucose, insulin, and toxins. Mm-hmm. If your body didn't store it in fat, it would store it in organs and you mm-hmm. would be dead much quicker and you would be aging much quicker. So your fat is just excess. Just mm-hmm. look at it as excess. It may not be, it doesn't mean you were an undisciplined person. It means that your body had during the years that you didn't quite understand the principles of eating, mm-hmm. perhaps your body had to find a place to store it so that mm-hmm. you stayed alive, and it did it in fat.
Yeah.
Okay. So now when you apply the principles and you're not losing weight, then a good question is to ask the body, like, what is it that I need to do to be able to help you feel safe to drop the weight? Mm-hmm. And oftentimes that is toxins. Yeah. Sometimes it's toxic thoughts. You've got to like stop the judgment. You've got to relax and just mm-hmm. stop trying to muscle your way to weight loss. But it is there to protect you. And what I find, I'm sure you see this mm-hmm. with your people, is once you find your rhythm with weight loss, it's literally like somebody just pulls like mm-hmm. a big thick winter coat off of you. I can see it here in my clinic. Like people come in 1 week time period and I'm like, oh my God, like your face is changing. Your waist is changing. That is such a different approach to weight loss than just hopping on the scale and seeing that the numbers are what you want. It literally, your body will shape shift as you figure out your formula.
And I think the whole weighing yourself daily, like I have women in a group, the group has only been in existence for a little over a week and they're on the scale every day. And it's like their entire mood lives and dies by the results that they see. And so I'm very much of the belief system. I didn't grow up with a scale in the house. If I did, I wasn't aware of it. And I never step on the scale because I just kind of go by how my clothing fits.
Exactly.
That's usually my clue into, okay, you've overindulged or maybe you need to cut back a little bit. But I think we do women such a disservice that we are kind of born and raised largely believing that it's a number on a scale. And I've seen women who like the number on the scale may be higher, but they're actually leaner because muscle weighs more than fat tissue does.
Right.
And yet they'll still beat themselves up, or they want to be a particular size. And I'm like, have you ever been that size? Well, no. Okay. Well, like what's realistic for you? And you know, what's something that's sustainable? Like, I don't want people to say, oh my gosh, I had to kill myself to get to this particular weight or size, but it's not sustainable. And they're not satiated. They're not sleeping well. And so those toxic thought piece, I think, is so, so important to bring up. I'm so grateful that you brought that up, because that's the discussion that most of us are not having. We're not talking about how disruptive that can be. And those limiting beliefs, you know, people, if they're constantly stressed in their brains about, you know, whether it's saying themselves, you're a bad person because you haven't, this hasn't worked for you. What are you doing wrong? This worked for five other people. And I just remind things, we're our own N of one. Like, each one of us are our own bio individuals, and it might require something completely a little tweaked a little bit differently for each one of us to work successfully.
Yeah, it's so true. This is what I love. Again, I'm back at the blood sugar reader, because when you get on the scale, it's not really telling you anything other than if you're a good person or a bad person. Right. I mean, really? But the blood sugar reader will tell you, what did dinner do last night for you? Mm-hmm. What did your fast do for you yesterday? How are you managing your blood sugar? Mm-hmm. And you're going to have to bring the blood sugar down in order to get the ketones to go up. And when the ketones go up, it's a sign you're burning fat.
Right.
So now you can actually see in action what's working for you. So, and then the other thought I had on that is, I've really experimented with this on my in my 40s, which is, there are times when I've been fasting a lot and dropped a lot of weight, and I'm maybe a little bit underweight, and I feel like my sex hormones are worse when I don't have enough fat on my body. And I'll be 51 in October. And I was thinking to myself, what if a healthy woman's body, especially going through menopause, mm-hmm. is not supposed to be like what we see in magazines?
Yeah. Absolutely.
What if we're supposed to carry a little extra fat? Mm-hmm. Because in fat is where estrogen is.
Yeah.
And we need estrogen to protect us from heart health. And we need some good estrogen to make sure that we don't get breast cancer and ovarian cancer. What if the goal at 50 is not to, you know, look like I did at 20, because for my hormones, I need to carry a little extra weight.
Yeah, it's definitely a delicate balance. And I find one of the discussions that's starting to come up frequently now is bioidenticals versus synthetics and those kinds of conversations. And so obviously it's a very personal decision for every woman as they navigate perimenopause and menopause. And for anyone that's listening, you know, our body makes predominantly estradiol as the primary form of estrogen until we go through menopause. And then our primary form of estrogen is estrone, which is made in our fat cells. So what Dr. Mindy is talking about is, for thinner women in menopause, if you're not doing bioidenticals or synthetics, you know, is your body properly supported? And I guess that's obviously a discussion that everyone has to consider with their own healthcare providers. But I find that a lot of the women I know that are navigating the beginning of their menopausal years, those are discussions that, you know, there's a lot of controversy, obviously such a personal decision, but something that, you know, you bring up that's really great. Cause you look at a lot of the people that are in Hollywood, I use that as an example, because you see the outliers of society. These are people that are freaks of nature anyway. And then you add in the added pressure of having to look a particular way, even as they navigate middle age. And so it's such a challenging question. It's funny, when I hit perimenopause, I went and bought every book on perimenopause and menopause to read. And so I can say without a doubt, there was very little information that was out there that wasn't fear mongering. But I was humored to see Suzanne Summers, for those of us, like, I'm really dating myself talking about, you know, Three's Company from the 70s. But she actually was onto something when she was talking about the food piece. You know, she was talking about how frustrated she was as she was hitting perimenopause and menopause, and what little information there was. You'd think by now we'd like get on the bandwagon and realize that women do indeed need really good quality information. But when women come to you and they're trying to make decisions about how to navigate that space, what are some of the resources or some of the recommendations you make to them about how to go about making the best decisions for themselves?
Well, the first thing I would say is, before you hop into bioidenticals or HRT, ask yourself if you've cleaned your lifestyle up. Mm-hmm. So in the menopause reset, I map out 5 things that I think every woman should do as she goes through menopause, and fasting, keto variations, feed your microbiome, detox, and make sure you're not rushing. You're what I call a rushing woman, just, you know, with a chicken with your head cut off. So if you have dealt with those five things, then, and you're still struggling, then that's where bioidenticals and HRT can come in handy. But the problem is that we're going to those medications too quickly without fixing the problem. And if you don't fix the problem, it's going to come back and bite you at 60. So if this is why I'm like, I wish I could just sit every 40-year-old woman down and go, okay, let me tell you what's about to happen. And here are the five things you're going to need to focus on as you go through 40. And then when you get to the other side of that, you're going to be so much happier in your 50s and 60s. But it's like any other medication. If we put a Band-Aid on it, then we never really get to the root cause. It's going to come back and bite you at some point.
And I think that's so valuable because, you know, being a traditionally Western medicine trained provider with some functional training as well, I agree with you wholeheartedly that that's the approach. And I know even for myself, you know, I see a nurse midwife who I adore. I love her personally and professionally. And we have these discussions, you know, every year I go in, it's like, you know, you're getting closer to that point in time where you may want to think about your options. And what I've appreciated and valued is that she gives me the information. We talk about it. She knows how I feel, much to your point that the lifestyle and nutrition piece is absolutely critical because, you know, we put a Band-Aid on a problem. You know, I find a lot of women come to me and they're like, well, I've been on bioidenticals for 5 years and I'm still getting this and this and this. And I'm like, okay, well, what's your diet like? What's your self-care like? You know, they feel like they're being selfish or they're not able to advocate for themselves or, you know, their kids go to bed at midnight, so they can't go to bed earlier. And I said, I've had months and months and months of my kids going to bed a whole lot later than me. I've just had to accept that. Like, I have to go to bed early. I'm in puberty years.
Me too.
There's no shame in mom going to bed before everyone else. Now I tell my husband to put the kids to bed.
Yeah. No, but it's a joke in my family. I'm like, it's 9 o'clock. I'm out. You know, and they're like just starting a movie or something. Yeah, I'm like, okay, well, I could sit here. I'll pass out on the couch, but otherwise, I'm out.
Fall asleep.
Yeah, exactly. Right. There's that. Yeah.
Can you please share your opinion on the latest Ozempic craze? So this is semaglutide. This is this GLP agonist. This is the drug that a lot of celebrities, not just people who are obese or diabetic, are using to help lose weight. Do you have any experience with it?
I don't have any experience with it. I recently heard about it a couple of weeks ago, but and I would actually flip this one and ask you on this because the way I look at every single drug is there's always a consequence. Mm-hmm. And so you can't ever a drug where people are dropping weight. Finally, there's a consequence to it. So make sure you know, read what the adverse reactions are to it. The other thing that I would say about drugs like that is that you are really pulling yourself out of your natural rhythm. And the whole goal of what you and I are trying to teach is how to eat and fast according to your natural rhythm. Now you've forced the body to do something. And where is the nat? It's just like birth control. We're manipulating the body. So you may see your friend use it and you're like, oh my God, they lost so much weight, but just sit tight with this drug. I promise you. Couple of years from now, we're going to start to see the dark side of it because there's no perfect drug out there.
No, it's very true. And I do have clinical experience with this drug and certainly have read a lot about it. There's different ways it can be utilized. Kind of the standard way is it takes a couple of weeks to get to a point where you're at a full dose. But the two main side effects that I see with my patients, and I don't prescribe it, let me be very transparent. Sometimes I work with people who are already on it. Number one is nausea, significant nausea, like pregnancy nausea. And if any woman that's been out there that's been pregnant, that's not fun.
No.
Number two is constipation because it's slowing gut motility. And so imagine you are trading. Maybe you don't have the healthiest lifestyle. Maybe you're weight loss resistant. You're feeling desperate. And this seems to be this panacea. And this is not to suggest there aren't drugs that you may need a drug and there's no shame in that. Like, let me be very clear. I take thyroid medicine every day because there's no other way my thyroid's going to be optimized because I've done all the other things. But I think it's important to understand that when we introduce these kinds of drugs into our body, there are side effects. Yeah. And right now, the two main ones that I'm seeing are constipation. Like I had a woman who said, I just don't even get hungry at all. Which is concerning because you're missing out on opportunities to hit your protein macros. Yep. You're very likely you're dysregulating normal hormonal communication within the body, because your brain thinks you're full, but your stomach could still be very hungry. And I just think about when we're looking at predominantly women north of 40, we're already at risk for sarcopenia. The more muscle mass we lose, the more insulin resistant we become. And that really sets us up for a lot of health issues. So if you use semaglutide, if that's what you choose to do, just be very aware of the side effects, be aware of the net impact of not getting enough protein in, the muscle loss piece. And lastly, I just interviewed Dr. Amy Killen, and she was mentioning that now people are kind of microdosing semaglutide so that they get the benefits, but they're not eating and they're not losing as much weight. But she and I were talking about how there's this very fine line of just being careful, understanding like the point is not to never eat again. Like we're not looking to develop an eating disorder by virtue of medication. But I think that my dogs are agreeing. I think by virtue of that question, it just speaks to the fact that we're seeing a lot of information in the media. It's very confusing. People are trying to make sense. And because a lot of celebrities are using the drug, people then assume that if it works for that celebrity, then it will work for them as well.
Right. And the sarcopenia thing is big because you and I have talked about this, that, you know, you need more muscle as you age, but what most people don't realize is you need muscle to be more insulin sensitive. So if you're losing muscle and you're losing weight and you're like, oh, I feel great. I'm like, yeah, a couple of years from now, like there's going to be a boomerang effect. So it's new. If it's the hot new thing, typically I back away from the hot new things and say, okay, let me just see how this is going to play out.
Yeah. And I really think, you know, one thing that I know we both really speak a great deal on is the lifestyle piece, like really leading with lifestyle before we start adding supplements, before we start adding medications, if that's the direction you need to go in. And I say this with love, but it's really important to be that methodical. I think for a lot of people, we've kind of conditioned our patients to ask for the drug first and then maybe consider the lifestyle piece after the fact. And I always say, start with lifestyle, then move forward. You know, if you end up needing medication, then so be it. Okay.
I feel like too, on that point, that you could apply that to everything, bioidenticals, HRT, cholesterol medication, like ask yourself, have I done everything with my lifestyle first before you go on to that? So really well said.
Well, what's interesting is Dr. Mindy does not know the next set of questions that I have, but ironically, she just touched on them.
Oh, nice. A lot of,
exactly. Exactly. See, it's all this synergy between us. Okay.
I know. I love
so it. Cholesterol, fasting. Okay. When people whose high cholesterol, so I'm going to paraphrase, when people have high cholesterol that cannot be explained, what information should we be looking at in terms of nutrition?
Okay. So if you have high cholesterol, the first thing I want you to think is your liver needs some love. Like let's support the liver is making cholesterol. It breaks it down, gets it out into the body. So when we look at what we see, and I've seen this so much in my community, that when we look at the liver, we got to look at the gallbladder. We got to look at the common bile duct and we have to look at the small intestine. So the easy first thing to do is make sure you're eating enough bitter foods. That would be like, let's start there. Second thing is, I'm a fan of fasting for anything that's going on in the small intestine because SIBO, not that this person has SIBO, but if you had any dysbiosis in the small intestine, to date, there hasn't been a lot of great supplement remedies for that, but fasting will bat that stuff down. So make sure that you're cycling your fast and maybe even go in. I like for gut health, I like a 24-hour fast. Outside of that, then you've got your castor oil packs and your coffee enemas, which I think are good. But in general, we need to think liver when we think high cholesterol, especially before we get on a statin, because we know that the brain needs cholesterol. The other thing I want to point out, and you and I have never talked about this, is I've seen some research showing that at different times of our cycle, we actually have different cholesterol surges. So if you're a cycling woman, make sure that you're looking at where you are in your cycle, like in the follicular phase and that like day one through like day 15, it's natural for total cholesterol to go up. Now it goes up in HDLs, which is great, but you need cholesterol to make estrogen. If you're a perimenopause or menopausal woman, you know, your body might be trying to make more cholesterol in order to make estrogen. If you go on a statin, and you shut that down, now we've got a hormonal problem.
No, it's such a good point. And you're right. We have never talked about this, but yet it makes complete sense that where we are in our menstrual cycle vis-a-vis having lab testing can be incredibly impactful. Yeah. And obviously I used to prescribe a lot of statins, and because that was traditional evidence-based medicine, let me be very clear. I was following the party lines, but I had an NIH researcher who every time she came in, you know, my cardiologist colleagues were like, maybe you can prevail upon her to take this statin. And so I would go in and we'd have this conversation. And she said, Cynthia, I'm going to share some information with you that I don't think you know, and that I always try to talk to the cardiologists about. And I was like, what is that? And I was very open-minded. And she explained what statins do in terms of impacting potential of brain health. Got so anyway, talking about statins, so I had this wonderful researcher from the NIH, and when she explained to me physiologically what's happening when we take statins and the net impact on cholesterol synthesis and how that impacts cellular membrane health, it took me back like 100-fold. And I immediately that day called my parents, both of whom were taking statins, and I said, I want you to talk to your doctor about what other options are available. And then I had one parent who went off and in conjunction with her healthcare provider. We're not telling anyone to stop their statins. Talk to your healthcare provider. My dad has remained on his statin and has been on that for probably 30 years.
Yep.
And in no way are we recommending you stop medication. The point of why I'm sharing this is that if we understood the net downward effect of statin therapy, I think most people would do everything they could to avoid being placed on a statin. Has that been your experience when you're working with people, helping them understand what statins do?
I think our age group and the younger than us, I feel like they're waking up to statins and they're asking. I think in general, I feel hopeful that a lot of people are saying, what can I do before medication? It's the generation ahead of us that I'm concerned about. And this is where we're looking at Alzheimer's. One out of three women, I just want to say it's the women, are getting Alzheimer's right now in their 70s. And this is the 70 and 80 year olds. Well, let's go and look at what they did, because if we don't want Alzheimer's, let's try to not do what they did. They were low fat, the low fat movement. And almost all those women are on statins. That was the thing you did, is you went on to statins. So I feel like, I just feel like it needs to be, it's written like, it's the prescriptions are written like, yeah, this is what you do. You're aging, you have high cholesterol, you go on statins. And I think we really have to put a stop to that, because there is more damage than good. And if you're on one, go back and do the lifestyle changes necessary, and then go work with your doctor to get off of them. I think we need to look at them like antibiotics. They should be done only if you've tried everything else.
Yeah. And unfortunately, you know, we live through that low fat, non-fat craze.
Yeah.
And so much of the information, I was telling my patients not to eat fatty meat, not to eat saturated fat, to avoid and fear fat, to use these, you know, fake Brummel and Brown. And I can't think of, you know, there's like a myriad of seed oil spreads we used to suggest in the interim. Yeah. And we're wondering why we have a whole generation of people that were never satiated. They were never full. You know, they became addicted to sugar very easily. They're eating too many carbohydrates. You know, it's really understanding that has had a really profound negative net impact. Okay. Couple last questions, because I want to be respectful of your time. These are like a grab bag. These are like the troubleshooting questions.
Love it.
Where is your starting point when someone starts fasting and they tell you they are fatigued or tired?
When they start fasting.
Yep.
Well, okay. So the first thing is, think of it like if you went to the gym for the first time and you're like, I'm going to get on the treadmill for 30 minutes. And you haven't been on the treadmill and you haven't been walking at that length, and you get on at 15 minutes and you're like, oh my gosh, like I'm exhausted. Then it's time to get off the treadmill and not do it. You just want to push it to that hormetic stress so that your body can start to adapt. So whatever hour you're at, if you're getting tired, it just then bring food back in. Let's eat. Next day, try it again. If it's let's say it's 13 hours, you're at 13 hours, you're tired. Next day, try 13 hours and 5 minutes, and just push your body so that you're gently causing it to adapt. We don't need to grit it, but it's the small little pushes of stress that in fasting that's going to improve that mitochondrial health. And then the other thing I would say is, again, I thought where you were going to go with this question, this is one I get all the time, is where do I start with fasting? And my recommendation is you start with food. And you change your food out. And the number one change you need to make is get the bad oils out and the good ones in. So it could be that maybe you need to clean some things up with your food in order to make fasting a little bit easier.
No, that's such a great point. And I would add, the only thing I would really add is the hydration piece. I think a lot of people think it's not important to hydrate, that electrolytes aren't important. And I remind them that if you're making these nutritional changes and you're eating within a compressed window, and you're losing electrolytes. We lose them every day. We breathe, we sweat, we poop, we pee, all those things, we lose electrolytes. But if you're also going low carb, you're going to have renal loss of sodium. So that means you're going to lose salt in your urine. And that can mimic a lot of the fatigue, muscle aches, just feeling not particularly clear cognitively. So electrolytes are your friend. Don't be afraid of them. We'll link a couple in the show notes as well, so that you'll have them available to you. But I think that fatigue is one of those kind of vague. It can mean so many different things. If it's persistent, obviously you need to get things checked out. But if it's transient, I think just, you know, as you stated, adjusting macros, kind of leaning into that, get the junk out of your diet, understanding seed oils, which I know we both talk about a lot. They impact the health of our mitochondria and our cellular membranes for a long time. Read every food label because they're in everything, unfortunately. Yeah,
unfortunately, for sure.
Okay. Last question. I had many, many questions about hair loss. If I start fasting and I start losing my hair, what does that mean?
It ties so well into what you just said. The first thing I would say is my shock in watching millions of people fast is how mineral depleted of a world we're in, and especially here in America. Our soils are so depleted of minerals that I would say anybody as they embark upon a fasting lifestyle needs to assume that they need more minerals. So to your point, mineral packets in water, I think is incredible. Second thing I would say is you also have to look at, well, what might be blocking a mineral receptor site, how the mineral's ability to get into a cell. And a lot of times we've noticed heavy metals, especially thallium. And thallium is in more fish than ever because of the nuclear fallout in Japan years ago. I'm on the West Coast and, you know, I will never eat a fish coming from the West Coast because of the amount of thallium that's in there. And we've done a lot of heavy metal testing in our community. And I will tell you that about 70% of the time, if somebody has hair loss, they've got high thallium levels as well. And then the third thing would be to check your thyroid and make sure that you've got proper thyroid function. And I know you and I, we haven't talked about this, but I'm pretty sure you and I agree on this, is that if you have a thyroid problem, you just have to make sure when you open up your eating window that you're eating, eat. Like, it, you know, it's the studies have shown calorie restriction is hard on the thyroid, not time restriction. So you've got to open up, when you open that eating window up, you might need to eat more.
Yeah, it's such a good point. And, you know, in terms of proximity, you are closer to Fukushima. That's where that nuclear meltdown was. And I can completely understand the hesitancy about eating a lot of fish. What's interesting is we used a thallium tracer on some of our stress testing and cardiology, but it was, I mean, when I tell you it was handled in such a careful way, even though people were giving minute amount of thallium as a tracer. So to back up, nurse practitioner in cardiology, we use specific type of chemical stress testing, and we use this isotope to be able to trace, you know, the heart to see where the perfusion issues were, if they were at all there. But very interesting about thallium, in terms of, you know, seeing, you know, high levels of thallium correlated with hair loss. I would also add, you know, mineral depletion, absolutely looking at thyroid, but also sometimes I will see it's a normal byproduct of weight loss. People will actually get this hair shed. We're seeing significant amounts of it post-COVID for people that have had the virus, that they're having very, very significant hair loss post-COVID. And just understanding that there's something, whether it's iron, thyroid, testosterone, post-COVID, whatever is going on, get things checked out if it's really significant. The other thing is for people who are breastfeeding or have been pregnant, sometimes you'll get a hair shed as well. So just understanding where you are in time and place. Well, Dr. Mindy. I hate to turn off the conversation because I know that we could go for hours and hours, but I do feel like we covered quite a bit of territory.
Yeah, we did.
And I hope we'll be able to have a round two because this has actually been really fun to do.
Yeah, no, I agree. And thank you for asking me food questions because, you know, in getting a book out there into the world, like after a while, you're like, can we talk about something else? So this was really mind candy for me. And yeah, I let's do more. I think that, you know, one of the things that I've been really emphasizing with Fast Like a Girl is that as women, we need to come together and collaborate. We need to support each other and have discussions like this. And what I hope the listeners will do is take what they learned here. Now go have that discussion with your girlfriends, because hormones have been like this, almost like this dirty topic that we're not allowed to talk about. And we need to bring it back into the light and have and talk about it on from whatever angle we can. So I love this. Thank you for having me.
Think about the average person. You know, in 2019, I had this long hospitalization, had 6 weeks of antibiotics and antifungals, which I needed because my appendix had ruptured and I had a slew of medical maladies that still completely defy the odds of how I got out of the hospital. But I remember reading one round of antibiotics, and I forget which researcher said it could impact your gut microbiome for up to 18 months. And so I was in my head thinking, is this going to take me years to be able to get back to a point where my gut is healthy again? And so, you know, what I want to caution people about is that there are going to be times where you needed that antibiotic or you needed to make a dietary change. You know, it's not as if because you've taken an antibiotic, this is an impossible mountain to scale. What we're saying is that there are things you can do. And I love fermented vegetables. Like I had a whole like Insta story on being in Whole Foods and being so excited because there were so many options, even some new ones. And so finding opportunities to kind of re-inoculate the gut microbiome with really healthy things. We know there are certain foods that impact our gut health in really non-beneficial ways, like sugar and, you know, the hyper-palatable, highly processed foods. So the less processed, the more akin to nature. I love the variety. Shop at your farmer's market. I don't get a plug by the farmer's market, but I love encouraging people to shop locally, support your local farmers, do a cow share if that appeals to you. I have to admit, the fact that you eat goat, that makes you a total badass. This year we tried some different things. We had elk, we've had ostrich, and we've had wild boar. So we're definitely like, we're dipping our toes in the pond, but like bison is a regular thing in our house and we eat a lot of meat, but I'm finding we have to kind of dip the toe in the pond a little bit just to kind of see, like, if the kids eat it, then I'm like, okay, we can buy it again. If they kind of go, like the elk, we've had elk a couple ways. Elk was a little too elky, but
too gamey. It's a little, it's a little gamey.
Like, we're going to try it.
Yeah. Have you tried liver or chicken hearts? Have you gone into organ meats yet?
So my mom is Italian, and I will say that my mom was crunchy before we knew what that was. So yes, when I was a kid, we ate organ meat. I didn't like it. I still don't love it. I do try like pluck. Have you tried pluck?
No, what's that?
So it's like a seasoning made with organ meat.
Oh.
And it sounds kind of weird, but like we've been using it, like I've been using it arbitrarily in things, and it really improves the taste quality, and it's super high. You know, it's interesting. It was gifted to me and then I decided to try it. And now I like it. It's gonna be part of like my holiday gift guide recommendation. Like, go check this out. I don't have an affiliate with them or anything like that. But I'm like, if it's a way that we can get more organ meats into people that are scared of organ meat, like what I used to do is I would freeze calf's liver or any type of liver, and I would kind of cut it into bite-sized pieces and then I swallow it. That's the only way I can get it down. I think I'm a hyper taster. So I suspect part of my issue is that it's the metallic taste is so strong that I just can't get beyond it. How about you?
Yeah, we ventured into chicken hearts this summer. So one of the upsides of the pandemic, my son was a senior in high school in 2020, and he started a cooking club where on Monday nights, his friends would come over and cook, and they started cooking all these different things. And so he got really adventurous. So I said to him, would you do chicken hearts? And he's like, yeah, I'll do chicken hearts. So I did, I just sauteed them in a pan with, I bought them at the farmer's market, sauteed them in a pan with garlic and onions and butter. And he loved them.
Wow.
He, 18-year-old boy, the rest of us liked them. we didn't love them, but they're packed with iron, which is so good for menopausal women, especially if you're going through that hemorrhaging where you are like having these really strong blood flow. Like you, chicken hearts are great for that. They're also, four chicken hearts have 68 grams of protein in them. So they are massively rich in protein. They're just a little creepy to eat. I'm not going to lie. They have a little aorta stuck on the top. So, you know, if you have to chop them up, my husband was going to put them in lasagna or something like that, do it. But if you can stomach some of those organ meats, they definitely pack some nutrition that you can't find elsewhere.
Yeah, and it's interesting. I interviewed Paul Saladino. I don't know if you follow Paul. And I remember one of the questions that came up from viewers that they wanted me to ask him is, you know, what did he eat that day? And he was like, well, I had spleen, I had pancreas. And I was like, Paul, you are a whole other level. And I you're a total badass, but I have a texture issue. I'm not sure I could get that down. Maybe if it was mixed in something, I might be able to process that. But yeah, that was... Whew, but hats off to your son. That's amazing. And good
Isn't that amazing?
For being so open-minded. That's incredible.
Yeah. I mean, I was shocked, but to the point that it is now, I think all humans would benefit from more diversity of foods. Mm-hmm. We really get locked into eating the same vegetables, same meat, same thing over and over. I can tell you between my online world and my clinic practice, we've probably run, I don't know, 10 to 20,000 different gut zoomers on people, and nobody, not one stool test has shown up that people have enough diversity of bacteria. That's crazy. Well, so you get diversity by improving the food, the diversity of the foods you eat. That's the bottom line.
Yeah. Well, and it's interesting because you obviously mentioned Dr. Terry Walls, who I have mad crazy respect for, and I've had on the podcast a couple times. And she talks about 9 cups of vegetables a day. And I remember saying to her, I was like, 9 cups? You really eat 9 cups of vegetables a day? Yeah. Which was astounding. But if you cook them down, then it's not quite so kind of insurmountable. But when she talks about polyphenols and talks about how important they are, that's why I drink green tea. I'm probably the strangest adult on the planet. I don't like coffee and I really don't like tea either. But I brew green tea every morning for my husband and myself. I let mine cool. I stick a straw in it and I slurp it down. That's my whole methodology because it's so bitter, but I'm like, it's good for me. It's good for me. And there are a lot of things, like I roasted radicchio recently. Ooh. And I mean, it is a bitter vegetable. And so I remember saying to my kids, I was like, I want everyone to have a couple bites. And my kids were like, wow, this is so bitter. And I said, but it's good. Like we need these things. Yes. There are nutrients in these vegetables and in these items that our body desperately needs. So I agree with you. And I would imagine most, if not all, Americans' flavor profile tends to lean very sweet because there's so much sugar in so many condiments and drinks and things like that. So our palates really, I mean, bitter is a lot to kind of wrap our heads around, along with organ meats and things like that.
Yeah.
Now, I want to be respectful of your time, but one of the other things that your book really does a nice job with is kind of touching on, I like to call them gadgets or fun things to play with, VFit notwithstanding, but I have a vibration plate behind me in our new house. My husband didn't know where I wanted it. So it literally sits behind my desk. And so in a vain effort not to sit a lot of the day when I'm working, I will get on that as a modality to do something. So what are some of your favorite gadgets that you integrate into your work with women that you find are very beneficial? I love that you talked about brain tap because I thought to myself, oh my gosh, I don't even know where my brain tap is. I bought it and then I'm not sure I've used it in a while. I'm like, maybe that will encourage me to go find it.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of biohacking equipment that I love and I've tried everything. Our clinic, actually, we have a hyperbaric oxygen. Awesome. We have a pulse PEMF. We have sauna, red light therapy. So we've put a lot in the clinic here, but those are expensive pieces that you have to go to a clinic and use. I'm now kind of geeking out on some of the home stuff. That's cool. Is that your Whoop?
That's my Apollo Neuro.
Oh, I don't know. I'm not familiar with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So for starters, hyperbaric oxygen, if you have a ability to get into a hyperbaric oxygen, that's my Benjamin Button machine, I call it. Like I come out of that and I'm like, whew, I think I'm like 25. It really, my workouts change, my brain changes, my energy, my moods, like that is amazing. But that's also not necessarily approachable for everybody. Yeah. I think infrared sauna is really important. I'm testing some of those blankets right now at home where you can just crawl into them, but you got to sweat. You know, a lot of estrogen and testosterone is made on our skin, so we need to be sweating on a regular basis. So infrared is great for that. Red light, I've been playing with red light everywhere from my face to my thyroid. This is actually really interesting. I had my thyroid tested at the beginning of the summer. I usually do a blood test at least every year on myself, but I really wanted to kind of micromanage to see where my thyroid was at. So a few of the numbers were off. The summer got busy. I didn't really take any supplements or do anything different. I did two things. I tried to reproduce the hyperbaric study that was done, 60 or sessions of hyperbaric in 90 days, lengthen telomeres and slow down aging. Wow. So I tried to reproduce that. It's hard to get 60 hours in 90 days. I did that. And then I did red light therapy with a Juve every morning, the little mini on my face, but I also was on my thyroid. I retested my thyroid at the end of the summer, and every single marker was normal. I had a friend look at the two, and I was like, what do you see? The integrative medical doctor, I'm like, can you look at this and tell me what you see? And he's like, your thyroid is amazing.
That's awesome.
I didn't take supplements. I didn't do anything. So some of these biohacks, red light. The other one I'm playing with right now are those PEMF mats. Mm-hmm. Have you done any of those at home?
I have not done that. That's why I was like, I'm hoping that you'll talk about it. So it'll encourage me to, you know, kind of do more work in that area.
Okay. So PEMF, here's what I love about PEMF. We have the human cells, our human cells resonate at very specific frequencies. Mm-hmm. And our frequency that calms us, that is really the best for our human makeup. This isn't even the microbiome. Our human cells is pretty consistent with the earth. So when you go out for a hike, you could say, well, I feel really good because I'm out in nature. But what you don't realize is that you're actually you're in a frequency. The frequency is 7.8, by the way. It's called Schumann's frequency. And you are at the same frequency that your human cells like in order to stay calm. Now, right now, I've got my phone next to me. I've got the computer. I've got lights on. When we are inside around a lot of gadgets, we are operating at a different frequency that's actually agitating to our human cells. So what's happened with PEMF, what is so amazing, is it puts you back into this calmer frequency that relaxes the body, it'll raise GABA, it will support your parasympathetic nervous system. For me, it's like a tranquilizer. So like we just got it a couple weeks ago and I got on it one night and within 5 minutes, I was like, boom. Like I literally went from chatting with my husband to asleep on this PEMF mat, like somebody had tranquilized me. Last night he gets on it and he falls asleep for 4 hours. Wow. And he came to bed at 2 a.m. I asked him this morning, I'm like, what happened? He goes, I got on the PEMF mat and I fell asleep for 4 hours and then I just happened to wake up. So it is really good, especially for a menopausal woman, because when that progesterone isn't there, you can pop on one of those mats and you can just get some sense of calm back to help with perspective, to help with your life. So Cynthia, try it. It's impressive.
Is there a particular brand of PEMF that
The one I'm using right now, because it's a woman-owned brand and I really like supporting women, is put out by Higher Dose. And it's infrared mixed with PEMF. It's literally like a yoga mat, but a little thicker.
Okay.
It doesn't roll up like a yoga mat. It kind of folds. So we've tried to figure out where we want to put it. It's on our couch right now. So the dog's
That's
even
why your husband
on it.
Fell asleep for 4 hours.
Yeah, right. Exactly. That, I don't recommend that protocol, but I really am. I'm pretty happy with it. It's so far so good. So check it out and tell me what you think.
I definitely will. You know, it's funny. What I was showing Dr. Mindy was the Apollo Neuro. And so it's a device that was designed, and there's good research, is initially designed for PTSD patients. And so I had the honor of bringing Dr. Dave Rabin on to talk about the technology. And so, pardon me, for shits and giggles, in 2020, I decided I needed one. And so I wear it when it's on my ankle. It looks like a home monitoring device, which embarrasses my children, but I generally wear it on my wrist. And what it does is it's gently getting yourself more aligned and not being in the sympathetic, being in the parasympathetic rest and repose. And so I keep it on my desk as a reminder, because it's not realistic that I'm going to meditate throughout my day, but I can put this on, and there's like 9 different cycles. But it's probably one of my favorite gadgets that I have, that I've been using, but I'm always looking for something new. Like, to me, there's always some other thing I can add to the milieu that I think can be super effective.
So you have 2 things now. You're going to get the V-Fit. Yes. You'll let
me
know.
My husband will be so happy to hear this.
Let me know how that works. And get the mat. Okay. And, you know, we have my friends that are all in the functional health biohacking world that are all going through menopause. We call it practicing parasympathetic, that you've got to search for ways to strengthen your parasympathetic nervous system. And when you don't have the progesterone that you had when you were 30, these tools actually become ridiculously important. And I had a lymph specialist who did a full lymph analysis on me recently. And she said, you're so sympathetic dominant that if you go into parasympathetic, you probably want to sleep. And I'm like, oh yeah, that's me. Like, put me in the hyperbaric oxygen, put brain tap on me, get me on the PEMF. There's no in between. I just knock out. And she said, that's because your sympathetic is too dominant and your parasympathetic is too weak. So you probably feel best in action. You feel best when you're doing it because you're stepping into your sympathetic. But as you and I both know, over time, not having a good balance from parasympathetic to sympathetic, I mean, that's what causes cancer and heart disease. And, you know, that's not an option for 70-year-old version of me. Like, she needs me to practice parasympathetic. So that's where I love these biohacking tools.
Yeah, there's so many great options, and obviously various, you know, price points, and there's something for everyone. You know, the way I got my engineer husband to meditate was to buy him a Muse, which is this headband that you wear that kind of trains you into meditating. He loves it. Like, it's his thing. He goes every morning after we take our walk outside without sunglasses on, walk our dogs outside for an hour. That's part of his thing. He goes and does his meditation, and then he showers. And so if you're listening to this and thinking there's no way my significant other, husband, spouse, et cetera, would ever do this, they will, especially if you are, you know, modeling good behavior for them. Well, I always love connecting with you. I am absolutely going to recommend that women check out the Menopause Reset. What I love about it, and again, I was mentioning this to you before we started recording, it's reasonable. Like, you can carry it, you can throw it in your purse.
Yep.
It's not so large and overwhelming. Like, I sat down and skimmed and read it over the weekend and earmarked a bunch of pages, which kind of drove a lot of this conversation today. But definitely a book that I would recommend for all women. And don't wait until you're in menopause. Like, do these things when you're younger so that you won't hit the wall, the perimenopause wall that I hit, which is what started the whole TEDx desire to do a TEDx, was because I wanted people not to be ashamed to talk about what's happening to their bodies. And I'm so very grateful to be connected to you.
Oh, thank you.
Just wanted to express my gratitude again for having you on. Please let listeners know how to connect with you. And let me just preemptively say, Dr. Mindy has a prolific YouTube channel, like, so much good resources there. Like, that's a great place to start, but where else can they find you?
I mean, I always say that YouTube is my passion project. Like you, I just have an unusual fascination with fasting. I think the reason I love fasting is the body is miraculous. Mm-hmm. And when you fast, you understand that for the first time. So every article I could ever find on fasting, any tips on fasting, it's all there on that channel. So you can go there and look at that. Instagram's kind of Like if, like I put my food, I put my life, I put my dog, I put my kids. Like if you want to see like what those five things that I talk about in the menopause reset, if you want to see what that looks like, come find me on Instagram. And if you get confused, you can go to drmindypelz.com. And I love, by the way, I have to say that the idea behind the menopause reset came from my YouTube followers. Mm-hmm. They kept asking me, what are you doing for menopause? What are you doing? And I was like, well, I'll just put it in a book. And then I realized, like, if you're going to write a book for menopausal women, you better keep it short because she doesn't have time and she doesn't have the brain focus. So I love that that women can read it so quickly.
Yeah. Well, thank you for taking the stigma out of what is a normal process for women to go through. And thank you for, you know, getting the conversation going, because I think there are far too many women that are suffering in silence, that don't realize things could be better for them. And so that's why it's so important for us to continue to keep the conversation going so that people can learn and be inspired.
Yeah, agreed. Agreed. And thank you. I mean, again, I really feel like as women, and you and I are both out there helping this generational place that women are in, is that the first is we have to bring it to the surface. We have to bubble it up. And as you know, there's only one person can only get the message out so much. We need to get more. And not to speak poorly of the male health influencers out there, but honestly, I feel like, you know what? If you want to talk about menopause, don't go to a 50-year-old or 45-year-old man. Come to some 50-year-old women that have gone through it and are living this with you. So kudos to you for having this conversation and everything you're doing as well.
Thank you.
Hey, if you like this video, you guys are going to love this video, and I'll see you there.